Hello and welcome back to the Retro Asylum. This is episode 267. Happy birthday, Retro Asylum! 10 years!
Woo! Yes! Woo! Get in there.
The UK's longest running retro gaming podcast. The UK's award winning retro game podcast. Matt, over to you, just to prove that you are alive.
I exist. So you hand it over to me.
Introduce yourself, Matt.
Hello. Hi, everybody. So I'm Matt. I've been on the podcast once or twice before in the last 10 years. No, welcome along to this 10th anniversary episode of Retro Asylum, as Dean said. Dean's got a montage coming up a bit later on, and you'll hear the award-winning nature of that. And I did come back after one of the awards, just to say that now. So we've got the whole team with us tonight. So you've heard Dean already. How are you, Dean?
I'm very well, thank you.
We'll go Steve. How are you, Steve?
Very good, thank you very much.
Chris, who's held us up immensely on this recording.
Like,
how are you, Chris?
Hours.
And he's just...
Do you know how many podcasts I've recorded in the last 6 weeks, and I've never had an issue until we start using all this newfangled rubbish?
Little violin, mate. How are you, Chris?
How many have you recorded in the last half an hour? None.
Welcome, Chris. And Mads, how are you, sir?
I'm fine, mate. Fine.
Good, good. You're
it's not just Retro Asylum's birthday. It's also Mads.
Oh, yeah. Well, it was yesterday.
Happy
anyway.
Birthday to Mads.
48 again.
So anyway, we got the whole crew together tonight, and I thought... Well, Dean, I think we've got to go to you first because you started this podcast alongside Andy, or you can correct me on that in a moment. What, you know, at the time, there was nothing else in the UK like this. I think there was one other retro podcast doing the rounds, Retro Gaming Roundup. And there was one HMPS or whatever the initials were prior to this. But you started this with Andy. Tell us why, what, and where.
Well, basically, we were working on whatever it was called, 1H. Yes, what was it? The 1 hour monthly podcast show. That was it. It rolls off the tongue.
HMPS Andy, basically.
Yeah, yeah. And we focused on all aspects of gaming. But being the busy bee that I was, I never really had time for the current gaming of the time. So I was still playing Amiga games, Spectrum games, a few console games here and there, mostly via emulation.
As you made a good point of in one of those early episodes.
Episode one, indeed. All right.
Yeah.
You emulate
so,
that.
Yes, I think, I don't know if I suggested it, but me and Andy both come to the conclusion that we wanted to focus on the games that we used to play. So that's how it came about, really. And Glenn was up for it as well, who also hosted on the other show. And it went from there. I think Andy came up with the name, although I seem to think I did, but he says otherwise, so we'll go with his word. And the logo was what I designed, and it's basically the Yul Sinclair logo, but with the Crash magazine. If I've got a Crash issue here. Yes, I have. The Zaps. From the Crash logo. And that's how I come up with the logo. So it's an amalgamation of those two.
Which remains to this day.
For our listeners, I'm holding up a Yul Sinclair and an issue of Crash as well, yeah. So, yeah, that was about it, really. Like you say, there was nothing else around at the time. Retro Gaming Roundup had, or still has, a British guy called Mike. But they always focused more on the console stuff. Well, entirely on the console stuff. From what I heard, you know, the episodes that I did listen to, and they were very, very long. Don't want to criticise them, but yeah. it was really long, drawn out stuff about Atari, about Sega, about Nintendo, which is fine if you're into that. But we wanted to talk about the Amstrad, the Spectrum, the Commodore 64 and beyond, and all the other systems, you know, the BBC and what have you.
We still intend to cover the Amstrad at some point. In the future.
Yes,
you are on dodgy.
We have covered it. We have covered it.
Covered it in shit. Sorry.
Keep it clean.
Keep it clean. I'm only messing.
You'll get all the hate messages. You do realise that, don't you?
I get all the hate messages.
Because yeah. You're the only one with an email address.
Yeah. Well, that's it, yeah.
So, Dean, how did you, just to wind back, how did you meet Andy and Glenn? Where did they come from?
They came off the internet. I was
lonely.
Right. Yeah. was... No. Andy used to do the 8-Bit Wars videos. He was one of the first people on YouTube to do the comparison reviews, yeah. You know. And he never really slagged a lot of the games off. And there was a few games I thought were really rubbish. So I started commenting and saying, no, that's rubbish. The Spectrum version's a lot better. And you know,
you said quite... that was fantastic and it's not.
Yeah, basically. And we got speaking and then we met. Where did we meet? I can't remember now.
So the expos were starting then.
It was the expos, yeah. Mm. We met one of the expos and, yeah, it went from there.
Nice. Nice. Mm. And the relationship blossomed into what it's become now, of course, and there's been a stack of hosts.
Yeah, we're happily married now.
Yeah, that's it. A few kids.
A few kids,
which you sold off a couple of times. And
adopted Glenn.
Yeah. When he left, Dean, I've got a question for you. When he left, did you think that was it? Or did you think the whole thing would just fizzle out? Or did you think we'd still be, 7 years later?
That's a very good question. At first, I thought, do I really want to take this on? Not full-time, because it's not a full-time job, but there is a lot to do running the show.
Because you were still putting episodes out. What was it by that point? Bi-weekly, was it?
Yeah, it fluctuated. It went weekly. When Andy handed the reins over to me, I thought to myself, I can't do it weekly. There's no chance of that happening.
Go daily.
Yeah, we'll go daily. No, it went back to monthly-ish, you know. And my philosophy is if you just put them out when you can. Don't make deadlines. You know, we're not a professional service, although in some ways we are. Just have fun with it. And that's what I've tried to do. That's where all the spoof commercials have come in and, you know, try to have a laugh with it.
Absolutely, yeah. It's turning into an interview Dean show, this, isn't it? So anyway.
Yeah, it's quite good, isn't it? I like this.
Enjoying this? Yeah. All right, we'll take the limelight off you now. So I joined in about 2012. Steve was a little bit behind me. Was it 2013, Steve, you come along?
I think so, yeah. Like, I don't know.
And we all announced ourselves as our names on the forum at the time, which is quite cringy when you look back on it.
Yeah,
You didn't, did you, Matt, or did you?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think it's on the montage that Dean's got later on.
Yeah. It's funny because, obviously, my forum username was Swainy, which is just my surname with a Y on, which everyone in school called me anyway, so...
Easy.
It's not really inventive.
Mine's nice and easy. Yeah, I didn't call myself the Spectrum Colour Clash or anything like that. You know,
Captain Colour Clash.
So, Matt, what do you remember, Matt, about your first episode? Then, do you remember being nervous? Do you remember was it a monumental moment in your life?
Oh God, yeah, it's like up there with losing your cherry and getting married, basically.
Nice.
Yeah.
bigger in some ways. It's bigger than that.
It is so much bigger. I mean, what this is stamped on the world, Rich. No, so seriously, I don't remember the first one. I think it was a little Team 17 segment I did. Was it? Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sure I appeared before that, but then I did my first actual hosting gig, let's call it.
The other bits were edited out, Matt. It was only that one that was your first appearance.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, very good. Very good, Chris. You're here all night. So, my first hosting gig was with Foggy doing the Amiga races, which I remember really clearly. And I was doing it down my mother-in-law's house. For whatever reason, we were staying down there that day. And I remember getting quite drunk before it because I was so nervous. So I had to get sort of like 4 or 5 beers down me because I'd never spoken to Foggy before. And I'm hosting a show for the first time. And it was probably awful listening back on it. I don't know, actually.
No, it's not.
I think I edited out a lot of definitely. But I think I come off the back of that buzzing quite a lot, actually.
Yeah.
I always wanted to do a show with Dean. He was never available because I thought I'd get on quite well.
That is my excuse.
Exactly. So, you know, I've learned my lesson on that one. And yeah, just getting involved, you know, and yeah, I was nervous to begin with. And when I've listened back on some of the earlier ones, I don't think my hosting style's changed much, which is really worrying. And my voice still sounds as bad as well, you know, when you listen back on your own voice, you hate it. But it's just nice to be a part of something and then not part of something, then part of something again, and then not part of something, as I've left a few times or throw my toys out of the pram, basically, going, like, I can't deal with it anymore. I need to just go and do something else for a
it's
while.
It's the fame. It gets to you,
it does,
it,
mate. It does. It's being recognised in the streets.
Having the press outside your drum all the time.
It's awful. So, yeah, it wasn't. I wanted to be a part of something. It was a time in my life which wasn't good, so I needed to get on something, and I thought I could do this, so I did it. And I enjoyed it. I'm still here today, sort of. So, you know, here we are, sort of 9 years later after I started, which is the true anniversary, I think, anyway.
We'll have another party next year.
Absolutely. And yes, listeners, I am still here. So, yeah, that's what I remember of it. And Steve, you started as a writer. I don't know what you were writing. Love letters to Andy, was it?
I can't remember. Yeah. Well,
we used to have a lot of articles on the website.
We had a website, didn't we, really?
Well, we have still got the website, and we can still add articles if anyone fancies writing them. Steve forgot to do part of the job.
I wrote at least two articles.
Yeah.
So I can't quite remember how I got involved properly. I remember listening. It wasn't as you'd first started. You had at least probably 20 episodes out by the time I got involved. I started listening, and this is Retro Asylum. I never really listened to 1 HMPS or whatever, because I thought it meant a 100 mile per hour service.
and that's the kind
wasn't
of thing,
missing no much.
That's the kind of things you get downtown on a Sunday morning about 1 o'clock, and it's Steve, 100 mile an hour service.
That's it, the 100 mile an hour service. So yeah, I'd started listening anyway, and I'd just started getting back into retro, and I did a search, and you're like the only ones who come up and as like a retro gaming podcast. I thought, give this a listen. And I was hooked. I loved it because you were talking about the stuff that we love. So you were the only ones talking about it. I listened to a few different retro pop gaming podcasts. Like you said, the thingy one was dead long, the retro gaming thingy roundup.
Retro gaming roundup.
They were dead long. And really they focused on, like you say, talking about the arcades, talking about Williams, talking about our Atari.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting good stuff.
Really good.
But
really
you had
good
to have a lot of time in your hands just to listen to it.
It's great when I was driving around for work a lot. That was a really good podcast for that.
Mm. I'm not knocking them. They are a really, really good podcast, but they weren't scratching that itch for me. They weren't talking about anything that was 100% relating to the things, the memories that I had. And then I found you guys and I started listening. And I was like, these are really good fun. And they are really talking about stuff I remember. All the 8-bit stuff. Even when you did focus a fair bit on the Speccy, but even when you did.
Yeah, because me and Andy were Spectrum boys. Although Andy, he had had a few different systems, you know.
Yeah.
Where I think back then, most people did just stick to one system. I had the Atari, and then I upgraded to a Spectrum. A lot of people would say it's the other way around. I downgraded, but but yeah, I think that's how it was for a lot of people. You had that one system, and then you'd upgrade later on to a 16-bit machine.
But this is the thing. So even though you were talking about Speccy games, a lot of those Speccy games are on the Commodore 64 anyway.
Yeah.
So you're talking about stuff that I remembered, and I was like, I'm loving this. I'm hooked. I'm into it. This is brilliant. And at the same time, I was sort of getting into my own little retro thing, and I'd set up a Facebook page called Press Play on Tape. And that was where I just wanted to write about games at that point.
Yeah.
Because I had loads of mates who were sort of getting interested in it. So I set this page up. I got plenty of likes and people following my page. It wasn't a lot. 50 people probably following the page. But at that point, it was exciting, so I started writing little articles about games that I used to love, blah, 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 big feature on Action Biker. and then I think I got in touch with, I was listening to some of your episodes, and I think Sam said he was looking for some extra stuff for the website, or he said something along those lines. So I sent him a message. I found him on Facebook, or maybe he was giving out an email at that point, or he was. I think he was, actually. Sent him a message, and he was like, what have you got? So I showed him my Facebook, and he went, oh, this is great. Do you want to do some articles for us? So I was like, yeah, I'd love to. So wrote a few articles for it. He was getting me to post them on the website. I came down to Play Expo when you guys were there.
Yep.
I remember you talking, but going down, I think at this point, Ali was involved as well.
Yep.
So I thought, it was in Manchester, not too far from me. I thought, I'm going to go, and I'm going to see if I can meet up with you guys and say hello. So I went. I ran into Ali at first, and then you said on the show something about a competition, and if you turned up, you'd win some games, and I won Tetris for the Game Boy, which was worth about £2. but it was really cool. I got to meet Ali, then I got to meet you, and I got to meet Andy, and it was really good. And I was like, these guys are great. And I think you had a little stall. I think you were handing out some flyers or something. I can't quite remember. But at that point, I went back, did a little bit more writing for the website, and then Sam turned around to me and he said, I think I'd done a couple of little Skype calls with him, and he said, you need to come on the show, mate. I was like, what? And he was like, yeah, just come on the show. He said, like, you know loads of stuff about this, what we're talking about, and you're fun to talk to. Come on an episode with me. So I was like, all right. He said, in fact, do us a clip. So I did the stupid clip that you put in the intro, Dean, where I'm talking in my phone voice. Hello, this is Steve. Press play on tape. Where I sound like an idiot. But I went on that episode with Sam, and I think we did, Mr. Sid versus press play on tape. I think.
Yeah.
Chris will know. That this is our resident historian.
Well, I didn't think that was your first episode.
Or is it the Click Adventures one?
No, it was definitely was the Mr. Sid. Now you wouldn't let Steve near a point and click adventure episode.
Had a quit. Had a quit. What was it, Chris? What was it?
It was that one was your first one. I didn't think it was, but you guys were adamant and I went back and listened to it, and it was your first episode.
That was the first one.
That was the first episode that you actually took part in. I think you'd had a clip on a previous
one. I think the point and click episode was where you had your first clip where you said about you're a writer for Retro Asylum.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
So yeah, maybe I submitted a clip and then Sam said, do you want to come on and do an episode? And even at that point, he wasn't saying be a host. He just said, come on an episode with him, which I think was the first time like he'd had anyone with him on an episode as well.
It was, yeah. Yeah, he'd done a lot of solo stuff.
Yeah, he was great.
He used to do the...
His music stuff.
It was the music focus. This is my life, didn't he?
He did one with David Whittaker and Matthew Cannon.
Matthew Cannon one's great.
That's something we don't do anymore, is solo shows. I don't think we should, but it was something we did a lot of back then, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, for me, Sam was actually very good at them, but I tend to, I think there's something always, whenever I listen to other podcasts doing solo shows, there's always something missing.
Do you know what? I think it ends up being a bit scripted, even if you're not, you've got to follow. You've got to follow because you're not bouncing off anyone.
Otherwise, you'll just ramble.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what it ends up being. However free-flowing you might think you are, you're always referring back to some sort of notes. Yeah. Whereas,
and then it becomes quite boring to listen to if someone sounds as if they're just reading something.
Yeah,
yeah, it's amazing we made it past the first year, really.
Well, to be fair to Sam, he was brilliant at those. He'd done a lot of research.
I'm just saying about, the solo episodes. I mean, I'd done a couple, and they was always music-based because you could speak, play some music, speak, play some music.
Yeah, break
it's
it
easy
up.
To do, and I could knock them out in half an hour.
Yeah. Yeah.
And but anyway, it was usually when Andy had arranged to record a proper full episode with the two of us, and something had happened, one of us couldn't do it. So that's why you ended up with shows like that.
You had an A to Z of Specky Games or something like that.
Yeah, that Spectrum Music, Top Tens.
And I did
tunes, arcade tunes.
And I did a retort to your Specky one, didn't I, Dean?
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, C64 one. They served their purpose well, like you say, but I think, we've grown and we wouldn't want to do that again unless it was a little tiny segment in a show. Mm,
yeah.
But, there we are. So anyway, nice one, Steve. So, and then you turn full-time person.
Well, yeah, so pretty much Sam asked at that point basically said...
I'm off, you see need you to later.
Come on No, he did at first. He did in the end, but he didn't at first. Basically, he said... He said, mate, you're natural. And would you want to do more shows with me? Because I've really enjoyed having someone on with me to bounce off. So I started doing them with him. And then at that point, I think he turned around and said, mate, you could do this by yourself if you wanted to. He said, you're through the door now. Just get involved with everyone else. So I was like, cool. Yeah.
Plus, I've got an idea about doing some books and I'm off.
Yeah.
To make my millions. And sponsor the Retro Hour.
What's all that about, eh?
I think they're more regular than us. It's fair enough.
Yeah. So anyway, then Mads come along, like a whiz from beyond the English oceans. What got you over here, Mads? Because I know you were doing the game club for RGS at some point on their forums.
Yeah. So what got me over here was Paul the Driscoll, really.
And lots of cash.
Lots of cash under the table, yeah. Now, I've been doing the game club and recording a little bit with the Retro Game Squad people for a couple of years at that point, I think. So we were just having fun discussing the games there, and I had a lot of long discussions with Paul Drisk. So at some point, he just asked me if I wanted to join him and try to record a few episodes of the Retro Asylum, see how that would go. And I joined him. I recorded my very first episode was on Mega Drive Shoot 'em Ups, I think, about 5-6 years ago.
Yeah, I wasn't allowed on that one.
No, probably not. But that was a good one, a good episode, because there were some great games, great shooters on the Sega Mega Drive. So had a lot of fun discussing those. Planned a lot of extra new episodes, and then the Drisk left. So I was in a bit of a limbo, really. But you guys said that you wanted to keep me on, so
yeah, we did.
Here I am, 5-6 years down the line, still here.
An asset.
Did you used to listen to the show, Mads, before you ended up joining?
Do I dare say this thing?
No. Be honest, mate. I don't mind.
Just close your eyes, ears for just a second. I love listening to stuff like some of the interviews episodes that that Matt did, for example.
Some great interviews earlier. Yeah.
But I actually wasn't really a listener before I started recording for you guys. And then
I was right about him, boys. Never did like him.
I would dip in and out. I would take the odd episode here and there when there were some stuff that I was interested in. But I've never listened to the entire back catalog. Still haven't. Probably won't. But
what?
Honesty is the best policy, man. Of course. Love it. Well, it's always good to have. I mean, it was great when you come on board, and we were going through a bit of a what's the word I want to use? Tumultuous time with stuff then, and it was, you know, there was a lot of people on board, wasn't there? And naturally, when you got a big team like that, things I don't want to say egos or anything like that, because it wasn't egos, but it was, we were just conflicting a little bit because there were so many different personalities going on, and I think that's natural to happen. But where we landed after that is where we are now. And that brings us on to Mr. Worthington there, who joined us. And, you know, I remember when either you sent in an audition or something like that, and Dean said, look,
Dean, did you ever make anybody else audition, or was it just me?
No, loads of, we had episodes where there's auditions.
Was that like find a talent spot?
It was X-Factor.
Yeah. I am the Simon Cowell of retro gaming.
Yeah, have you got the X-Factor?
But you know what, it was, I remember it really plainly that, you know, there's four of us, there was me, Dean, Steve and Mads, and you know, we were really tight knit at that point as mates as well as hosts. And you know, this other person wanted to come in, and it was really difficult because, you know, suddenly there's this whole new dynamic that wants to come along. And we were a bit worried around the friendship side of it, not the hosting side of it, it's all the friendship side of it. Is he going to fit in? And I think we can all say you don't fit in at all, and we can't wait until you go. But no, in all seriousness, I think it went so smoothly in the end that you just ended up being
one. You failed your probation, mate. I'm sorry.
Well, I'm actually going to use this episode to announce that I'm not leaving, so you're all stuck with me.
So, famously, Chris joined for the episode where we did the gaming club episode on 720 on the C64, and he started his time here on the RA.
He was on about this.
He started his time here on the RA podcast by cheating. I mean, we had a high score challenge. I was getting quite good at this, but he was getting some amazing scores, and nobody could figure out. Actually, at some point, we checked the high score tables on what's it called, Twin Galaxies.
Twin Galaxy.
He was beating the world record. So what he was doing was he was just using the credits. He was just pushing continue and calling them lives instead.
Do you remember that old concept in games when you have a little counter in the top corner? And something happens, like you fall down a gap or you get hit by an enemy or you get shot in your ship, and that counter goes down one. What's that called again? Is it lives?
It is called lives, but there are no lives in 720, mate.
No one told me it was a no-death run through 720. I still maintain 3 years later that I did not cheat.
Yes.
I told my family and everything. I'd set the world record, and
I bet they weren't interested either.
Absolutely not.
So anyway, you were a listener, you were a patron, however the hell we say it. We still don't know, do we? Prior to that, and what made you want to come on this show other than for strapping lads who you just couldn't wait to be in the same room with.
It was me, Chris, wasn't it? It was me.
It was Mads.
It was Mads. It was the dulcet tone of Mads. It was something I couldn't resist. No, actually, it was very selfish, if I'm being honest, why, and I'll come on to it in a sec. But yeah, I was a listener back in probably from around 2016. In fact, the first episode I listened to was, Steve will remember this, Steve and Mads playing Supercars.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
I remember you did a live stream. I think it was a video. It might have been a YouTube
Didn't
video.
Didn't I commentate on that or something as well on one of those?
I think it was just...
That rings a bell.
We definitely did a commentary one as well. I'm pretty sure of it.
Yeah.
I reckon it was about episode 145, maybe a little bit later, maybe about 160-something. And I was out running, and I just Googled it because I'd got my Amiga out of storage. I'd been to my parents, got my Amiga out, and I was starting to get back into some of the games I played when I was a kid. I've always been a gamer, but I had left the retro stuff behind and was playing whatever the current gen was, so yeah, Xbox 360, PS4. But then I don't know what piqued my interest. Went up to my parents, got the Amiga, brought it back, started messing around with it and playing some of the games I played when I was a kid. And that led me to think, to be honest, podcasts have exploded in the past 5 years, haven't they? I mean,
absolutely, yeah.
They're everywhere. Every single program on TV has an accompanying podcast now. You know, if you want
radio show,
yeah, whatever you're into now, that you can absolutely guarantee there's a million and one podcasts about it. But I had never listened to a podcast, and I just Googled. I actually didn't Google podcast. I Googled retro gaming. I think I just simple as that. Retro Asylum was one of the first hits that came up. So I went onto the site, had a look. This looks quite interesting. Downloaded the latest episode, which is the Supercars episode. And then I was out for a run listening to it. I actually was laughing. As I was running, I was laughing out loud listening to the banter between Steve and Mads playing Supercars. And if people haven't listened to that episode, go and look it up because it is genuinely hilarious. And that's what got me into it. And I think within that episode, Steve had mentioned the Simon Butler interview. And I think he'd mentioned that he got a mixed response because you're Simon. So I thought I had to go and listen to that. So I went back and listened to that one. And then there was a From the Vault episode. That remember you used to do those From the Vault?
Yeah, when we're short on time.
Yes. But for people like me, Dean, who...
Yeah, it's a good way of getting...
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So I think it was on the Footy Game. So I listened to that with Paul Davies and somebody else. And I was hooked, to be honest. And then from whenever an episode dropped, I'd listen to it straight away. I was going back, selecting some of the back episodes I was interested in. And that really got me into retro. I bought a Dreamcast about a week later. And from then on, I've just amassed stuff. And then...
Chris. I was just going to say, it does make me wonder how much money has been spent as a result of people listening to this show.
Yeah. I think it's eye-watering.
And we've done it ourselves.
We get some of it.
Mm. Affiliate scheme on Retro Asylum.
Well, I don't even like to think about how much I've spent, but it's clearly thousands. Yeah, so, and I wouldn't have done that had I not got into the podcast. I'm sure I probably would have just carried on messing around with the Amiga, and then it probably would have went back away.
What was the selfish part of it, Chris?
So the selfish part of it was starting to get into this retro gaming stuff, starting to get these systems, starting to mess around a bit more with emulators again. And I was getting the usual choice paralysis stuff. You know, I'd boot up an emulator, dabble with a bunch of games, and then turn it off because you can't really get into stuff doing it like that. But that is what everyone does. And why not? You know, we have infinite choice. We can fire up a system now, an emulator for a system. We can play any game ever released by and large right now, right here. In 30 seconds, we could probably be playing it. So what I used to think to myself, I used to listen to some of the episodes, you know, I don't know, a random episode about a publisher or a developer. And you guys, you know, Steve and Madge used to do a lot of these kind of episodes, like the PC Engine episode, you know, picking 10 games, talking about them, having played them. And I used to think to myself, how cool must it be just to have a purpose to play this stuff? A real reason to boot these games up and spend more than 30 seconds playing them. And I didn't listen to Retro Game Squad at the time, so wasn't aware there was a game club out there. I would have absolutely loved that back then. But that's what really got me thinking, how good would it be to have a purpose to play these games? And that's what made me think, I thought maybe I was good at it. You know, I've always, you know, I'm an amateur dramatic guy, and I've you know, kind of first put my hand up when it comes to presentations, and I'm used to speaking publicly in certain, you know, certain forums, but I did never know what I'd be like, you know, sitting there on my own like this, you know, with a microphone in front of me. So at that point, I dropped Dean a line and said, look, you know, maybe I could bring something to the show. I don't know. And Dean quite rightly said, well, look, you know, we got, I think at that point, Chris O'Regan and Paul were still around.
Yeah.
And Dean, you know, kindly emailed me back and said, look, you know, we're all right for now, but, you know, let's have a look. You know, if someone was to leave or things change. And then Paul Davies announced he was leaving. So I thought, I'll chance my arm again. And emailed Dean again. He was like, well, look, why don't you send something in and we'll have a listen. So I was really nervous. I remember it was a Monday evening, kind of coming here in study here, shut the door and said to my wife, right, I'm just going to go and record this audition piece. So did it, sent it in, and obviously the rest is history. And then, you know, invited onto the show to support Mads with the Game Club, which, you know, Mads and I still run the Game Club 3 years later.
Well, it's worked out to be a brilliant partnership, hasn't it?
Super, yeah. You know, and it is wouldn't underestimate it to say that not only have I become part of a community, it gave me what I wanted, gave me the purpose to play the games, but I've made four of the best mates that I have, you know, and that is genuine. Yeah, that is absolute Mads looking round on the camera. But that is truly, you know, I joined to give me a purpose, what to play on my Amiga. I will stay forever for the friendship that we have.
And that's...
From the bottom of my heart, I really mean that.
And you know what? I think this is why this show really works. And it's always been a bit of a cliche, as it sounds like you're talking to mates about games. But it really is. You know, I genuinely, you know, I've threatened leaving a couple of times in the last couple of years, but it's just because my own mental state isn't always particularly stable. But it's the friendship that absolutely keeps me here. If I was to leave the show, I'd still be in the Telegram chat because I genuinely see you four as mates. Genuinely, you know, I talk to you about things I don't talk to anyone else about. You know, and nothing too dodgy, obviously. But you know, I'd know.
You should get that rash looked on.
Yeah, mate. Yeah. I've doctors tomorrow, Mads. Doctors tomorrow.
It's too late now. It's too late now. I'll fall off.
but yeah. Anyway, exactly. And there's the point, isn't it? We got a good banter between us, and there is just a chemistry. I'm not saying it's not on other shows, but it is a chemistry between all of us. Any one of us can work with any one of the others, and we just get on really well. And
honest with you, Matt, you say it's on other shows. I listen to a lot of podcasts, as you know. I talk about a lot of podcasts, and I love a lot of podcasts. I really do.
You seem to have found other hours in the day none of us have found.
Well, you know, I listen to podcasts when I'm get out the shower, when I'm driving, when I'm running. You know, I listen to
They're your thing, aren't they?
Yeah, it's really. To be honest, I mean, I don't listen to a lot of music anymore. Obviously, I listen to The Last Arcade all the time.
Of course.
But I don't listen to a lot of music. I listen to a lot of podcasts. And I enjoy a lot of podcasts. I think there's some great, great podcasts out there. But I still think what we have that is very unique, there is some great partnerships out there. You know, you get this, I won't mention any names, but there are certain podcasts, if you get two hosts together, you know it's going to be great chemistry. It's going to be a great show. But I do think we are unique that within the group, as you say, Matt, you put two of us together or three of us together, any two or any three, it will be a great show because the chemistry really comes across. And I still think, you know, when I listen to the 80s episodes, which I think amongst the best work
Definitely.
That Retro Silent have done, I really do, you know, just two of us. Yeah, and that chemistry is just really, really strong and makes the whole thing so listenable.
It is, and yeah, you're right, that they are three of the best episodes that ever come out. So I'm going to go around quickly. Has anyone got a highlight of their time here? So Dean, starting it, I guess, but is there a highlight other than starting it?
All of it. I think what Chris was saying, I've made so many friends through doing this. You guys, you know, ex-hosts, our listeners, you know, there's people that... It's like John Veal. The other week we was up in Manchester. I'm walking along the street of a night and I've heard, hey, Dean! And it's John Veal. He made me jump out my skin, but he recognised me. I recognised him. I wouldn't have been up in Manchester if it wasn't for this show. It just wouldn't have happened. So it's just, for me, it's just brought me or introduced me to a lot of really nice people. The whole thing's been great. you know, there's been some funny moments. Once we play the montage reel, you'll hear some crackers, but there's loads of stuff. I was trying to go through old episodes that I would have missed. You know, the 8-bit wars, all of that was really funny doing that, and it was enjoyable. I received a lot of flack over it, especially from Amstrad owners. But, you know, the 80s episodes, the feedback we got on that, and it was me and Steve, I think we had a really good time recording that.
You could tell.
Mm.
Yeah. Mm. We're just talking about stuff that we love.
Yeah.
And that's what we do on this show, I think. Whereas, you know, a lot of other shows, I'm not knocking them. They've got their own routines and ways and whatever. You know, they're reporting on the news and it's all quite serious and, you know, the interviews. And we can do that. We come together as mates and, like you say, banter, it bounces. And
yeah.
I think you're right. I don't think you get that quite the way we do it anywhere else.
I don't.
So who's your favourite host, Dean?
Me.
good answer.
I'm joking. That's the thing. When I listen back to anything I do, I don't feel like I'm a good host compared to you guys.
That's rubbish.
I listen back to the first episode and I don't feel I've really improved that much. So,
yeah, you were great back then.
No, I wasn't.
But no,
I'm not now.
The thing is, though, I don't think we're hosts, and I use air quotes on that. We're just people who talk into a microphone, and we're quite proficient at it. And then the chemistry comes alive and makes it what it is. And it really is that horrible cliche of is two mates, three mates, four mates talking, five mates talking, whatever. And that's why you don't have to class yourself as a host, because we are just talking about something we're all passionate about.
Do you know what's brilliant, Matt, is that 10 years ago when Dean started it, that was the philosophy that he wanted to bring you. That was the philosophy, right? You know, we're mates down a pub talking about things that we love. And well, Dean, go on. Was that right?
I was just going to say, no, that is right, but you know, I can't take all the credit for it. You and Andy,
that was the philosophy. That's what you designed as a mood for the podcast. And what's brilliant about, and testament to you, Dean, because you've been the one continuous right the way through the 10 years, despite all the host changes and the different types of personalities that have hosted over the years, one thing for me that's never changed, and maybe at times there was people who maybe wanted to change it, but one thing for me that's never changed over the years has been that philosophy. You know, and even now, despite, you know, Mads and I do the Game Club episodes, and it has a different focus to the more nostalgia-based episodes, but it still maintains that underlying philosophy that, okay, we might be just talking about one particular game, but we still maintain that. We're mates down the pub, we have a giggle, you know, we're just talking maybe about in more detail about a particular game. But it's still got that vibe, that feeling that you and Andy set up. And that's been, to keep that going for 10 years, it's just phenomenal.
Well, I couldn't do that without the hosts that have been on the show throughout that time. You know, there's been a lot of episodes that I don't appear on. I've always been there in the background, kind of producing the show, I guess. And, you know, so have you, Steve and Matt as well, a lot of that time. And like I say, you can't do it without a team. You know, it was never just me or it was never just Andy. We've all helped each other along the way. Yes, there has been some hosts who people who worked on the show who didn't agree with the way I had done things, and that's why they've gone. There's other hosts who have just gone of their own accord. You know, they've said what they've had to say, and they've wanted to move on to other things or do their own shows a different way. But yeah, it has always, like you say, it's always been that couple of guys or a few of us chatting as if we're down a pub, talking about games, you know.
And I'll tell you what, Mads, right, and we've said it before, he's got better English than most of us, but it's the fact that he can join in with the humour, you know, as a non-native English speaker. Like, I can't even talk the lingo and I'm from this country. And you just fit in like an English person, and probably your most eloquent speaking person on this podcast. Certainly more eloquent than Dean, that's for sure.
Easily. Who isn't?
But yeah, I think that works as well. But you also bring a unique take because you're from Denmark, basically, and you had a different culture over there as kids. I mean, it's probably ultimately the same, but you know, you didn't get the magazines like we did. You couldn't buy games as easily, and it's probably mostly pirated, but it was just, you know, you've come into it with a slightly different slant. But actually, when we talk about it being a UK podcast, we've got one fifth of it. Yes, sorry.
At least.
One fifth of it is not UK.
Maths is never the strong point, eh, Matt?
It wasn't, mate. D at GCSE. Yeah, yeah. You're not from the UK, Mads, but you're like our UK cousin, basically, aren't you?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I've always been fascinated of the UK retro gaming or gaming scene back then, just so I've always followed along. As with most of my music I listen to, really, it's from the UK anyway. So so definitely have a strong UK focus here anyway.
And Mads, do you use English in any other setting apart from this?
So I used to at my last job, and of course I've worked as a researcher and a postdoc for many years, so that would be English most of the day anyway, at least writing English most of the day and reading it as well. So yeah.
So not now.
No, not now, not anymore. We have a few non-Danish speaking at work. But
so you need to stay in the podcast, otherwise you'll lose your English?
Yeah, probably.
And you can't come to this wonderful country of ours and talk, talk the language.
We'll try and leave you, but you can't leave us.
Right, guys, shall we play this montage then? Because I spent minutes making it.
Oh, yeah.
Welcome to episode 1 of the Retro Asylum podcast. I'm your host, Andy, and with me, I'll let him introduce himself, is...
Mr. Dean Swain, also known as Swainy.
And with me is...
Glen83100!
Yay!
Hello, everybody!
So what game have you chosen this week, Andy?
Well, I haven't chosen one yet, Dean, so I think I'll let you talk about your one while I think of one to choose.
Okay.
Fantastic.
Now, Glenn, earlier on, you sent me a little text message.
So, saying what? Oh, no, I've not said it again, have I?
No, you haven't sent me a message that says, kiss, 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 love you. This time you put, I got my retro gaming news, Alan Bread coming to iPhone.
Oh, Alien Breed.
Ah, that's what it is. Because...
my dyslexic.
You put Alan's Bread. It sounds yummy, though.
Matt, go by the name of Denaris on the forum.
I'm Foggy, and today, this show is about my own personal top 10 Commodore 64 games of the year 1983.
This is Retro Asylum, the UK's number one retro gaming podcast show.
I remember being continually wowed by arcade machines. You know, you hotly anticipate the new, whether it's in your local video shop or, as you say, on holiday, you anticipate the new machines coming in, and every time they raise the bar, and it was just amazing to see the size of the graphics, the speed of the gameplay. I mean, that for me is what arcade gaming was all about.
The Sega Master System, while popular in Japan and Europe, really did not take off in North America whatsoever. That was heavily, heavily dominated by Nintendo's NES system. In fact, I saw a statistic the other day that said that there was an NES in one in every four homes in America. And believe me, that is a lot of NESs.
I've always been more of a game player rather than a techie. You know, of course, like many of us, I've been lucky to grow up slap bang in the middle of a video game boom. And I've been playing games with my family and friends whenever I can ever since.
I love this song of Commodore 64, but it's my fifth game, Test Driver 2.
It's not called Test Driver.
Test Drive 2.
Hi guys, this is Steve, aka Press Play on Tape. I'm one of the new writers for the Retro Asylum.
It's now Saturday the 21st of December 2013, and this week, this past 2 days, Retro Asylum podcast has become not just the UK's number one retro gaming podcast, but the UK's number one gaming podcast. That's right. So Christmas number one almost for Retro Asylum, because in the iTunes gaming podcast chart, the category of gaming, we've been number one for 2 days running now, which is absolutely fantastic. So big shout out to everyone involved in the podcast, keeping it running. Of course, Andy there at the top, and Dean for setting up in the first place. Andy and Dean got this together a couple of years ago and have done, you know, laid the foundations for what it's become. So that's a real good reward for all the hard work everyone's put in.
My name is Mr. Sid, also known as Sam, and today I am joined by Press Play on Tape, also known as Steve. Hello, Steve.
Hello, Sam.
How are you, mate?
I'm not too bad. How's yourself?
Yeah, very well, thanks. Really excited about recording with you, mate. It's the first time. I've only ever recorded on my own before, and I know this is your first Retro Signing podcast.
One of the reasons I think we all love retro games was because, you know, they were inventive and exciting, and part of that was because it was such small development teams. If they did a misstep, it wasn't going to bankrupt the company. So they were able to experiment and try all these crazy things.
Hello, everybody. My name is Paul Monaghan. Something a bit different, looking back on gaming magazines.
So, Steve, last year we were extremely lucky and fortunate, and through the voting of our listeners, to win the UK's Best Podcast Award of 2015. And this afternoon I've received an email from the organisers, and we've been entered into a different category for this year. We've actually been entered into the World's Best Podcast category. So, you know, we don't stand a chance.
And the winner is Retro Asylum. Congratulations, guys.
Come on down.
What's it look like on a green screen, Chris?
No idea, because I never played it on a green screen. Doesn't count to me.
Because we need to have a feel for, you know, the true Amstrad experience.
True Amstrad experience. It wasn't for me.
Well, it was for most people. That machine.
It was glorious. That monitor was glorious. Anyway.
Have you anyone played Greenbow Islands?
Hey, listeners, this is Mass. You know, the sexy one. Don't forget, Retro Asylum isn't just the UK's number one retro gaming podcast. It's also a scientifically proven aphrodisiac, so be kind to yourselves and subscribe now.
Hello, and welcome to Retro Asylum. I'm joined by Mr. Usual again, Mads Christensen.
Hello again, take two.
Dean Swain.
Hello!
And, last but not least, Stephen Erickson.
Hello!
So we have just done this before because we've just spent 3 minutes chatting about, well, not a lot, a little bit of chit-chat. And then Steve very astutely thought he'd just check whether we'd hit the record button. And what did you find, Steve?
We? Whether we hit the record button?
Okay, so...
Whenever you're ready, Chris. Whenever you're ready. Just start. Just start.
Hi guys, this is Steve, aka...
Just start whenever you want.
Thanks, man.
I knew you were going to do it.
It's like a ritual now, isn't it? It's like a ritual. It's got to be done.
Retro Asylum adverts, take one.
This is Retro Asylum, the UK's award-winning number one retro gaming podcast. The only retro gaming podcast with a Cockney, two Sousers, a well-spoken...
Hang on. Cut. John, it's not Sousers, it's Scousers.
Sousers.
No, mate. Scousers.
Sousers.
No, Scousers. You know, like the Beatles. You know, they do-do-do, don't they do-do. Scousers.
Scousers.
All right, run it from the top.
The only retro gaming podcast with a Cockney, two Scousers, a well-spoken DJ who claims that he doesn't live in Slough, and a six...
Cut. John, it's not Slough. Slough, it's a place. See, Matt, he lives near Slough, but not in Slough, but always keeps telling everyone that he doesn't live in Slough, which is what makes it funny. Alright, so...
Slough.
Not Slough.
Slough.
No, not Slough. Slough.
Slough.
That's it. Right, so, Slough and Scousers, not Sousers or Slough. Alright, mate, yep, run it from the top again.
The only retro gaming podcast with a Cockney, two Scousers, a well-spoken DJ who claims that he doesn't live in Slough, and a sexy-sounding Dane.
Lovely. Cheers, John. That was perfect.
Slough.
Yeah. Maybe it is best you stick with Hollywood.
So, guys, can we have a short break? Because I'm out of red wine, and I really only run on alcohol when I'm this tired. So...
So we went up to Arcade Club, obviously, a few weeks back, and it didn't go according to plan. We was hoping Mads and Chris would both be there. And I think there was a lot of disappointed people, probably none as disappointed as you two, because you couldn't make it.
Yeah.
It was a shame, you know. We was really looking forward to getting to meet you, Mads, in person.
Yeah, me too. But circumstances just made it impossible.
Yeah, no, so. I understand that. Yeah.
It'll happen. Oh, it'll absolutely happen, I think.
It will happen, yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
hopefully all five of us, eh?
Yeah, we need to do that. We do need to do that. It'd be great. Yeah. So we can actually all have a man hug between the lot of us, a group man hug. So you talked about Arcade Club there, Dean. Do you want to give us a little rundown? Because we haven't done the normal what have we been up to being
what have we been up to? Well, me and Steve ventured to Manchester and went to the Arcade Club and met a few of our listeners, and we had a jolly good time, didn't we, Steve?
We did. It was good fun. Like you say, a few disappointed people that it was me and you instead of Chris and Mads.
could you see it on their faces? Like genuinely see
yeah.
that?
Yeah.
So just the
yeah.
blood drain out of their faces, aren't
they? Yeah. No. They'd run up with a big smile and like go, what's that? When's Mads and Chris getting here? And they're not coming. And they go, okay, see you later. And that was it.
We're off to the traffic centre for the day.
Yeah, that's it. Getting off. It was really good, to be honest. It was a shame. It would have been really, really great fun. To have done it with Mads and not done it, but to have met up with Chris and Mads as well, because I think to have all of us there would have been, well, all of us apart from Matt, would have been quite an event. But we still made the best of it, you know what I mean? And so me and Dean got down there. I got down there on a Saturday, picked Dean up from the hotel. We shot over to Arcade Club, spent the day there, met plenty of like guys off the Discord, people just coming up and saying hello, having a chat. And then we went for a curry in the evening with about, I don't know, it was 15 people, 20 people? I can't remember. It was a lot.
About 15, I think, wasn't
it? 15, yeah. Wasn't it? And if there was anywhere I thought we were going to catch COVID, I initially thought it would be Arcade Club.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we're in a room with 200 people, there's kids running around, there's families, there's people coming up, everyone's touching everything. But everything's really kept clean, and they've got an enormous air conditioning unit blowing literally next to R-Type. So I was trying to play R-Type with this huge fan blowing at me, and I had my hood up and everything, and I couldn't play in it because it was too blowy. But they are blasting that place. So in the end, that didn't feel too bad.
Yeah.
But then we went to a restaurant for dinner. And that's where I thought we might catch something. And because that was just packed.
There was
15 of us, but it was full to the rafters. No ventilation. And I was like, if we're going to get it anywhere, this is it. We're going to get it here. But touch wood, we haven't got anything. Two of us, we've come back fine. So it's all been okay in the end. But yeah, it was a great weekend. We had a really good time. It was great to see all the different people that we met. I can't remember all the names because I am terrible. And we did a little recording as well afterwards, didn't we, Dean? We met up
with
Clint, Jonathan and Chris O'Regan.
Yeah, it was nice to see Chris again, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was good. It was really good.
He's looking really well.
He's lost about 5 stone, hasn't he? He looks great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He looks a lot younger for it, doesn't he?
He looks way better, really healthy for it. So, yeah, he agreed to come back to the hotel with us, and so did Clint and Jonathan. And they're two nice guys as well.
Yeah, really nice.
They're lovely. Yeah. They come to all the different retro events. They always come over and say hello.
Yeah.
They normally come for dinner with us, like just for lunch or whatever.
Big friends.
We've got to thank Jonathan, haven't we?
He bought us lunch. Yeah, we went to Burger King, and he's like, no, it's on me. And we're like, no, and he's like, no. And he's like, whatever you want. So I was like, right, I'll have the biggest drink. I'll have
a giant whopper,
an extra whopper. So we had lunch with them. And like I say, they come back to the hotel later on. And we will play the clip at the end of this. It's just a little catch up with us chatting in the hotel room at the end of the Saturday after we've been everywhere. And they're involved. But it was a good weekend. And like I say, the only thing that would have really made it special was if you guys had made it. But there's always next year. There's always different events. There'll be something else. You know, the circumstances that came along, there was just no way out of them. Do you know what I mean? So,
yeah, and of course you couldn't catch COVID there, mate, because all the COVID was down at Chris's place.
Yeah.
Well, that was it. Chris had caught
the entire house full of COVID.
House of COVID, I tell you.
Really?
All four of us were COVIDed up. And I was gutted as well, because as well as it being RA's 10th anniversary, it was my 40th celebration. That was all really, other than family stuff, I was doing. And Andy Gilmore, co-host of the Playthrough podcast and Discord member of Retro Asylum, he's 40 on the same day. So that was to be a joint 40th celebration. And obviously, I didn't get to do that. So I'm feeling...
I didn't realise that, and I think wish you make me birthday.
All you need to do, Chris, all we need to do is just celebrate your 41st. It's more unique, and we'll get us all together. Genuinely, we'll get us all together and just relive the 40th properly.
You're listening to Retro Asylum, the UK's number one retro gaming podcast show.
Okay, so, Arcade Club, 30th of October. It's a Saturday. It's not really been the day that we had planned.
It's not.
No.
But shall we introduce ourselves before we get into
We shall. My name is Dean Swain. Yeah, I've been presenting Retro Asylum now for 10 years, so hopefully people will know who I am.
I'm Steve Erickson. Joining us today is the one and only...
I'm Mads.
Mads.
And Matt.
Matt.
I'm Chris.
Chris Worthington.
Yeah.
Yeah. As you can tell from their beautiful voices, it's not actually those people, is it? For real? No.
No.
So... we are at Arcade Club for our 10th anniversary party trip.
Our 10th year.
My holiday. And we've been joined by Jonathan. Second name is Jackson.
Absolutely.
Good, aren't I? I
you,
can't remember.
Very impressive.
Second name, Clint.
Humphrey.
Humphrey, I didn't know that. Clint Humphrey. And the one and only Chris O'Regan.
I am Chris, yeah. I'm Chris.
We were pretending to stand in for our other host.
I was,
who
yes.
sadly couldn't make it.
So right. Chris quickly, V1 here. Hi, everyone.
Chris V1 is here with us. So we're quickly, very quickly... sadly announced that Chris and Mads couldn't make it, and Matt, couldn't make it to Arcade Club for this 10th anniversary, very sadly. I know they told us on the last episode why they couldn't, but it's been a bit sad for me and Dean to have to come without them.
Yes, because I think everyone was expecting Mads and Chris, and they were looking forward to meeting them rather than us.
Yeah, no one was looking forward to meeting us, which is a shame.
Yeah, but, there were some very disappointed looking faces.
Well, we started off with 50 people and ended up with 10.
It wasn't that low.
No, but it's still a fair old set of people. It's really lovely to see so many.
Yeah, there were a few more faces there. Craig Turner.
Really
Craig Turner. So we had a good turnout in the end,
actually.
Yeah.
About 15. The restaurant was really rammed, as you said. I was quite impressed.
Yeah.
But we'll talk about that in a second. But it's all good stuff.
So to quickly introduce Clint and Jonathan, they've been followers of the show. Now, actually, Jonathan told me today you started at episode one.
I did indeed.
That is impressive. And Clint, when did you start? If it wasn't episode one, you can leave.
No, it wasn't episode one, sorry, but it was about... 20, I think John informed me on, was it 20?
Is that when I joined? Probably.
Something like 2014, something like that.
So, yeah, I think that's when you started, wasn't it?
Was it?
I think so.
That's why I started listening.
Yeah.
But these guys, just for the listeners out there, these guys have been fans of the show for a very long time, right from the start, and come along to a lot of the events, nearly all of them, and always have a catch-up with us. They usually come to McDonald's with us.
Yep.
On our little, me and Dean go for lunch, and these guys come with us. And today, Jonathan, very nicely, bought us lunch.
Yes, very, very, very nice of you.
Yeah.
You got a bonus.
Bonus. So I thought we'll put him on the show, put him on the spot as a way of saying thanks. So there you go, thanks.
Thanks very much.
Yeah. So guys, before we get into it, how have you enjoyed today coming to meet us for our 10th anniversary? What's the outside perspective
excellent.
Like?
Oh yeah, absolutely excellent. I mean, as you said, we've met a few times over the years, but it's always great. I mean, putting faces to names for so many people. I mean, obviously we've met you several times, but we met so many more people today. People that we knew, people we've seen on the Discord channel, but just great to meet everyone, it really is.
Yeah. Clint?
Much the same, it's just great to meet people, get out, especially in COVID times, you've been locked in for a while. It's last time we saw each other as Revival in,
21, was it? Was it 2020, was it?
Yeah.
It was the final weekend.
Yeah.
It was just before lockdown.
Yeah.
It was weird, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was a weird event. It was a nice event. It was good. But
we all knew it was coming, I think.
It was nearly, wasn't it?
We were all nervous about it. But it was good. From that point, I've been dying to get out to another event for a long while and obviously waiting for something. When this popped out, it was a must-do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd like to quickly as well say thanks to the other guys from Discord who also joined us today.
Yeah.
I can't name them all off the top of my head. Well, you all know who you are, and thank you all for coming. Because I'm crap at naming them.
Yeah, I'm rubbish as well. But thanks for all coming
along. All you guys who came along today. It's been a fun day, hasn't it?
It has, yeah. I've had a few goes of some really decent arcade games.
Tell us about your victory over Renegade. Come on, out with it.
The first game I played was Renegade by Taito, 1986 game. Been trying to complete it for years at home. I have completed it once before, and it was in the arcade, you know, the original arcade machine. And yeah, first game today, I've done it, lost one life on level 3, then completed it, and started looping it as well. But walked away from it because, yeah, I was showing off.
Yeah.
Showing off. Give someone else a go.
Yeah. And then I put my name in wrong on the The controls were misconfigured, so, yeah.
So just everyone knows where Bury, the arcade club, there's another one, isn't there, in Leeds, isn't there?
Yeah. There's three of them,
Yeah, I think, is there three? I know there's an arcade thing in Croydon, but that's not the same. It's not an arcade club. But yeah, I think that we played a fair few of the titles, didn't we? But it's a phenomenal place. Three stories.
A lot of stairs. A lot of stairs.
You think you're down the stairs as you're coming out, and you're like two floors to go.
Good workout before you get on the machine, see?
It is true. I think this time round, I mean, last time and the first few times I've come to Arcade Club, I've explored all of it. Especially the first time I came, I was like, what's on this floor? Wow, look at this, all this stuff. And then the second floor, what's all this? And PC gaming and all this kind of stuff. But now that I know what's what, this time it's just straight to the third
straight
floor.
To the top.
It's straight to the retro. And that's where I want to be. I glanced, we walked straight into the bottom floor, didn't we?
Yeah, we had a very quick look.
Yeah, and then it was just, we haven't, it might be bad, but we haven't even visited those other floors.
Could you explain what that means? What that is for listeners who don't know, it's called prejudice, Chris. That's the layout of arcade club. So you're saying that the bottom, the first floor is
it's newer games. Well, it's actually a lot of linked PCs, I think.
Is that the ground floor? Which one's the? I don't know which way you're going, but on one of the floors. I've said this before, and this is no offense to Arcade Club, but I liken it to going in like the arcade in Haven when you go to a Haven campsite. And you take the kids in, and the arcade
machines.
It's all the lights, it's all lit up. There's like bikes they can sit on, there's basketball things. Like, you know, the place where you get the tickets.
All the kids, very good for families, absolutely brilliant for old farts like us.
There's no attraction in there for me. I don't want to go and see your lights and play basketball. Yeah. I want to go and play games I used to play. Yeah, it's too bright. It's great. And like you said, for families, it's amazing. And I think the next floor is the one with the PC gaming on, I think.
Yeah,
And that's brilliant for like.
That's not a bad.
For your slightly older gamers like who aren't like little kids now, I think your teenagers and stuff who play Call of Duty and stuff will just find they'll love it in there.
Yeah.
But for us, or for me, it's got to be the top floor. Like straight up to the floor. It's just history. It's just walking into the past.
Yeah. I love the way they laid it out as well. Yeah. Got these sort of. I remember we were looking for Green Beret, which wasn't there.
Devastated.
But we found a lot of other things. Yeah. And I sort of stumbled upon, oh, look, there's Defender. Oh, look, oh, no, there's Defender. but I just love the way they laid it out in chronological order as best they can, and also genres as well.
Yeah.
Someone who did it knew what they were doing. It wasn't just thrown together.
It's clever. Because like, there's certain spaces like within the corners, as you come out from the corners, is where the big multiplayer games are. So you've got the space quite... well positioned, you know what I mean? Yeah. It's nicely spaced out.
Plus, you've got the row of electro coin cabs, you know, the jammer cabs, which I think they look amazing. They're so big and beefy. Really nice.
Yeah.
It's
brilliant. You get
big, bright screens.
Lovely. You get a real wow moment as you walk in as well, you know, because if you haven't been in an arcade for, you know, quite a few years, you walk in, you hear it, you see it, you smell it really as well.
No cigarette smoke this time though.
Although, there's still machines that have got all the cigarette holders.
They do.
Still
on the machines. Yeah. It's
quite amazing.
You know, but it's great just to walk around and see that glow.
Yeah.
You know, you can't beat it, can you?
The cacophony of sound, like, I can't hear this, but somehow games like Robotron, like, oh no, you can. Totally can. Somehow the way they've done it, the Robotron, you can definitely hear.
Sorry, but we've just been joined by the 1036 to Manchester. We're in the hotel room in Bury now, and they've got the window open, and there's a train track outside. So what did we jump on first? I think it was Championship Sprint or Super Sprint.
Super Sprint
with the three turn player.
Always turn left.
Steve, you ruined it for me. I never realised that every turn was left.
Yeah, I pointed out to Jonathan that you'd only turn left in it, and I ruined it for him. but that's another one, and I said this to someone tonight, is that some of these games, it's because of the control mechanism that makes them
Yes.
What they are.
Because I had that on the ST. Yeah. As much as I loved it on the ST.
That's great.
It's great.
You just holding fire, Dan.
Yeah.
Pushing left and right.
And, yeah. and using a joystick at the time, Competition Pro. Now it's all D-pads because we know better. But, it's just not quite the same as spinning that massive steering
wheel. The wheel. Because you spin, let go, catch it. Spin it again, you catch it.
It's so good.
And the pedal as well. Using the pedal, it's all a combination.
But you were doing it one-handed.
You do.
I'm showing off.
You still work.
Yeah. I love that game.
It's super.
Especially little top downs. I didn't like that.
Super I'm old enough to remember Sprint, but let's not talk about that.
It's black and white one.
Black and white.
Yeah, that one.
Docks.
Yeah.
Such a cool game.
That's on the Mister by the way.
He's got. Take a drink, everyone.
Sponsored by Mister. VGA.
What else did we play? I played. There's another thing talking about the just the control mechanisms. I had to go over Arkanoid with the spinner.
So much better.
Yeah.
And like the home versions are almost arcade perfect. Like the Amiga ones, almost
incredible,
perfect. Mm. But with that spinner and the weight of it,
it's got weight.
Dialing, you can spin it. Same with the steering wheel, spin and let go, catch
just,
it.
You know, it's like playing Tempest with that one. Like,
it's just a different game.
So much better.
You saw later in the day as well, you know, and when it got a bit quieter, you know, people were gravitating to all the cabinets that had wheels and big controllers.
Yeah.
You know, that's where the crowds were.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. It's just a good all round experience. It's a good place to go.
Played Moon Patrol, didn't we?
We've done a few two player games, didn't we? Which obviously Moon Player, it's you taking turns.
Yeah.
I was doing terrible. Commando did better than me, but
Commando did quite well. But you
I was
beat
rubbish
me.
At Commando.
Yeah, but I managed to get to the the big double doors that are pouring out, and that bit. I tried to use the 8-bit sort of strategy of taking them out. No, but we did play 2-player. It's nice to be able to do that alternate because it's in there. All those arcade games have those 2-player things. It's great.
It does add a bit of competition, doesn't it?
It does.
Makes
we did it with Tapu as well.
Yeah, which I was appalling at.
Yeah, we both were because of control. Yeah.
Yeah, some of the cabs, I think they need to.
A bit gunged up.
I guess, you know, it gets very busy in there.
It must be hard when they're trying to keep on top of all those machines.
Yeah.
Keep them all maintained and stuff.
Yeah.
I was playing Berserk and I couldn't pull diagonals on a couple of them. You know what I mean? And that's a gate I need to pull diagonals to shoot robots. Yeah. You know what I mean? So. But I'm not knocking it because that's such an undertaking to keep that place ticking over with that many people in there, you know, and it's super popular now. And there's a lot of kids playing the old games now as well.
Yeah.
Really surprised.
Yeah.
You two were on Outrun 2 earlier.
Yeah, we were.
That was the first time I've actually played that one.
It's good, isn't it?
Yeah, it was excellent.
I play that a lot on the Xbox.
Right.
So is that the 2006?
Yes.
2006. Yeah, that's quite... You can't get that anymore, can you? I think
it's hard to get on. I was trying to get on PS2, I think it was.
Yeah, it's on a PS2 and Xbox original. Yeah.
I was saying to Steve, it's probably one of... It's not a modern game now, but it's still... looks fairly new compared to the stuff that we're used to playing. It is a good sequel.
Yeah. It's one of the few games where it's aged perfectly. It's like it's a brilliant evolution of the original. Brilliant. Like they took what was great about the original, added a couple of new mechanics with the skid, drift mechanic and stuff. The graphics look great, but it's still got the same vibe. It's
got that music as well.
Two player fun. I mean, it's a little bit bungee. You've got that bungee cord between you, and if you get too far ahead of each other, but
snap
you
back. Rubber band.
Yeah. But it's really good. It's quite smooth as very smooth.
It's a nice looking game.
Yeah. I mean, I was never a great fan of the first one, actually. I mean, it's had a wow factor you see. I remember seeing it for the first time in an arcade, and it kind of blew your mind. But I never really warmed the game that much, but the second one is great.
I think it depends what cab you play in. I played the sit-down version of the first one. With you got the speakers behind you, it's hydraulics.
Yeah, it's
great.
I loved the hydraulic. Yeah. I remember I went back in the day in Butlins, I was on it all the time. But I've still never completed it. I've always got to about really sort of the last sort of down the road, and I still couldn't do it today. I just couldn't do it. But one tough. Day.
Yeah,
there's multiple endings.
Yeah.
But the car does different things depending on which ending you reach. I think one of them, the car falls apart in Blues Brothers-like fashion. I want my favourite version is both Sega Saturn Home and 3DS, because they did it in 3D. It's really good. They did a really good job. Again, I don't think you can get that anymore.
I mean, Chase HQ, though, I think takes it for me as well. I mean, that's excellent.
I really like Chase HQ. Today, that machine was having a few problems. The graphics started glitching while I was playing it, which was putting me off. And
John, didn't you play the second one today? Was it Chase HQ 2 or something that you were playing?
Quite possibly. Mm.
They had a lot of follow-ups. I had. I don't think they had a Berserk 2, but it had Joust 2. And
which isn't such a good game, is it?
I don't like it as much as the original.
No, I'm not a fan of Joust either, though. I find Joust really floaty and hard.
I like Joust.
That was a first for me, Joust today.
Was it?
I've never played it before.
What do you think?
Really?
It's another game I used to play on the Atari 2600.
So what did you think?
It's getting used to your immersion type.
Yeah, it can be frustrating.
And then obviously flapping and keeping yourself up. But I think it's a game, once you get used to where you're travelling to, it can be quite good. I can see it, but yeah, I played it for a while. It's all right, it's good.
Are you familiar with Balloon Fight on the NES?
I think so.
It's quite a famous game. It's quite a go-to game for me anyway, for that system, although there's way better games on that system. It's very similar to that. Rather than you flapping, you are actually a little bird with balloons.
Yeah.
And they you pop the balloons, and then that's why it's called Balloon Fight. But it's still ultimately Joust.
Yeah.
They just couldn't call it Joust for Williams reasons. I think they're both very good games. But yeah, Joust 2, no, not really. But there are some, and they had a lot of Tron games as well.
I played Tron.
I played the discs of Tron. Yeah. That screen's got that like holographic,
reflective
screen. Yeah.
Yeah, they're lovely looking cats.
It looks so cool.
Yeah.
These things still manage to look futuristic in some way. Maybe it's my like brain coming from the 70s and 80s kid.
Yeah.
I still see like holograms printed on stuff.
I think some of those cabs, you know, there's certain ones with a bit of backlight and behind the instructions where they. There's one. What game is it? It's a Taito game. It might have been Jungle Hunt or Elevator Action. They're next to each other. And just the instructions, the text on one of them was in red, and there's obviously a backlight behind it. And it just, it's so bright and vibrant.
It's glowing.
You can't but notice it, and it looks lovely.
Yeah.
I was looking at that more than I was the game.
Well, sometimes that's the whole thing, isn't it? We forget that. Yes, the game is very important, but there's a whole paraphernalia around it, and the controls, and although some of the lighting is suitably dim to the point where you're going, what is this? Hang on. That's that. So I definitely found that with Defender, because I forgot it was a reverse button. I got that game. It's just the controls are just way easier.
Why did not have a joystick?
I'm
sure there is a version with a joystick, though, isn't there?
The original was buttons only.
Yeah,
I mean, I love Defender. I played it a lot on the 8-bits with a joystick.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
But when I played it in the arcade, which I did afterwards, I couldn't. Yeah. I just never got used to it. I played it quite a bit.
I quite enjoyed it. It took a little while to get used to
the
that.
Sound
it's like playing it on a keyboard.
Yeah,
it's the same as playing on a keyboard at home, isn't it?
See, I was playing Pac-Lands, which had a joystick, whereas the original arcade cabinet, which they didn't have today, is just buttons for left and right. But yeah, the version they had there today was just in a Goliath cab, I think, and it was joystick. I actually got quite far in it.
You like that game, don't you?
I do like that game.
Nobody knows why.
I can't understand why you don't. Again, you and Matt were trying to walk through the game.
I know.
You've got to run.
You didn't know you could run.
Tap the joystick or the buttons and you run.
You're right, it was Matt's fault.
Yeah. It's like running through Mario. You're thinking you always run through Mario.
Which is true.
Of course, there was the legendary Double Dragon moment, eh?
Yes, I did play it again. Sorry, people.
Is that another drink, by the way?
Drink.
Yeah, another drink, yeah. He's mentioned Mister, so he got that. Now
he
got a double
drink. And remember, for all your FPGA needs, go to MrFPGA.co.uk. Thanks, Nat.
Steve, you got to the end of RoboCop as well, didn't you? That's
one credit. In 3 minutes I did it. No, that's not true. Yes, I did. I did clock it, but I think it was about 15, 20 credits in the end.
That doesn't matter.
But the thing is, like, I did reasonably well on one credit. I think like,
that's
three,
a hard game. I can't
three,
get past that to
three or four levels in, and then once it just goes nuts. Then
it's
like you just certain parts of the game, you just bullets come from every single angle. There's just no way.
Is it anything like the 8-bit?
It's like the 16-bit. It's like the Amiga and ST version.
Yeah,
right. Just not rubbish. Okay,
it's a lot.
Good point, mate. Good point.
I am sure that the 16-bit computer versions came before the arcade version as well.
Quite possibly.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
The arcade.
I don't think they did.
I'm sure. I might be wrong.
The 8-bit versions. Yeah, I think.
They did.
Yeah. It's weird. The games are based on the arcade machine, but the arcade machine was licensed through Ocean.
Maybe that's it. Did they buy it off Ocean? Ocean had it first.
Yeah, they got the rights first. Data East went through Ocean to get the rights.
They get the rights.
Yeah.
There you go.
Okay, slightly back to front.
Because the Spectrum version, as you all know, is legendary.
Mm.
It was on top of the charts for months, I seem to remember.
It was a huge game.
Yeah.
As the film. The film was awesome.
Yeah.
So.
Mm.
So going off topic very, very slightly, as it's our 10-year anniversary, I'm going to ask you guys, as people who listen to the show, with it being 10 years, what you've stuck around with us for 10 years, so yeah. Why?
Are you mad?
Yeah, why? Possibly.
But yeah. No, I mean, if I'm being honest, I think I keep coming back for more because the passion comes through. You're knowledgeable. You talk about stuff that I'm interested in, and you're clearly interested in it as well.
You're still waiting for that Atari at the side.
Yeah, well, yeah. Fingers crossed, good thing.
He's over there. We'll give him that because then he'll leave. Yeah. Never give him it. Hints at it. Never, ever give it. Yeah. But yeah, so, you know, so you started 10 years ago and you're still listening to him now. So, you know.
Been a few changes over the time.
Just a few.
But yeah, no, I mean, I think for me, 10 years ago, it scratched that spot. I mean, retro is just something that you get sucked into, you know, it really does. And find like-minded individuals talking about stuff that you like, even if you miss out the Atari 8-bits, but, you know, it's just great. It just keeps you coming back for more. It really does. And the passion, and I keep saying that, but the passion just really comes through.
Thank you.
You know.
Yeah.
And how about you, Clint?
I mean, the same. I mean, obviously, but first of all, you stop listening because you want to get a bit of a nostalgia, but then you hear that the excitement for it, you know, through all those years, with like even talk around the Christmas times and the games, the Spectrum stuff. That, I remember there was particularly the one that you'd done, Dean, about the Spectrum music and particular games, and that flooded back to me at that time. I thought, I remember that one. And then you just continue with it. And then you guys have also influenced how much money I spend over the years. My room's starting to pile up so with a lot
meant
more.
Meant to sell it again. Yeah. Not listen to me. That's how it's done. Get it, sell it.
Well, I was saying earlier, wasn't I? It's strange that past few episodes, particularly with me and Steve on, we've been banging on about the Mr. FPGA. For all your FPGA needs, go to mr.co.uk. but the 10 nano boards have sold out.
Is it a coincidence?
Probably.
We promote it.
I mean, look what happened to the Vectrex. Look at the sky.
Look at the prices they've gone for. Yeah.
That's the point. You were on an episode of another podcast about that very machine.
I do like to talk about the Vectrex.
We do. I did insist to drag you on and you agreed to be on.
Yes.
Sorry, that's the other thing. We won't mention
what was that podcast?
It's your Kane and Ritz.
Kane and Ritz, I've never heard of.
Also 10 years old, so there you go.
So thanks for sharing those thoughts. The correct answer was Steve and Dean are awesome. Thanks for having me on.
You wasn't that bothered about Mads and Chris not turning up.
Who?
These guys are happy to see us.
Sorry.
Ended up on the show.
Just as an adjunct to that question, how do you think the retro video game scene has changed the most from 10 years till now, apart from the obvious people putting video games into slabs of plastic? What's the biggest change, do you think?
The price.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, it's weird. We've seen it get bigger and bigger and bigger, and everyone's expecting this bubble to burst at some point. And it may well do, but it hasn't yet, really, has it? You know, there's still all these different systems where they're bringing out miniature versions of them.
And then there seems to be more and more desire for them, you know what I mean? Like the Amiga one coming up.
Yeah.
It's red hot.
Mm.
It is.
All over it, you know what I mean?
A lot of people are like, what's this? And everyone's going, you'd be surprised.
Yeah.
I mean, they're bringing out the tank mouse. Like, why? Yeah. My perfect preferable mouse is the one that the later years, the more curved one. But they said, they want tank.
Well, they brought out that horrible joystick with the last one.
Yeah, I know.
The C64, you know what I mean? But they still did it for the nostalgia, but yeah.
Yeah.
I think the nostalgia is so strong, though. When you play something like that, you know, it actually takes you right back. You remember what you were doing the first time you played it. Oh, I used to love this game. Mm. You know, hours on end, you know, playing it, and you're right back there for that period of time.
Well, that's what's the magic about it.
Yeah.
The whole thrill of nostalgia is to relive those memories. They come back. You don't realise it. You put something up, and the music washes over you, and you haven't seen it for years, and you just feel that happiness and that. Limitless joy you had as a kid, you know what I mean? Because,
I still find it weird though that when we were younger, we were so looking forward to the next. When we were young, very good plug there, Steve. Anyway, as I was saying, years ago, we always used to look to the future, look forward to the next big thing.
Yes. Mm. And, I still remember bemoaning.
At what point do you start thinking, hang on,
this is crap?
It looks nice, but it can't play as well as the original.
There definitely comes a point, because I think we've gone from generation to generation. We've started right at the beginning or close enough to see the whole evolution.
Mm-hmm.
And I definitely agree with you there that at certain points, as we went from 8-bit to 16-bit, I couldn't wait to see what was next. And that jump from 8 to 16-bit was mind-blowing.
Yeah.
It's like suddenly, like, oh, there's parallax scrolling, there's loads of colours, the music's amazing, the sound, everything.
Yeah.
This is stunning. Yeah. This is almost like arcade games in the house.
Lost my mind.
Yeah, we're chasing the arcade perfect.
You're always chasing the arcade.
Yes, I remember playing Bubble Bubble on the ST thinking, this is spot on. It's not. It's really close.
It's a pretty good rendition. And then the same thing for me happened from the jump from the later Amiga years into the PlayStation 1 years.
Yeah.
And that was not, I wasn't like, when's this coming? It was me walking into HMV and Ridge Racer being up on a couple of screens and going, what the hell is that? Because I've never seen anything you could have in your house that could throw polygons around at that speed and wipe out. I was like, Jesus Christ, what is this?
The sound and stuff.
And the sound and the music and everything. So that was another one. Yeah. And that was the next leap up.
Yeah.
And so at that stage, I was still following, God, what's going to come next? If we're going from this to this, what's the next generation going to be? Like, so the PS2, and then what's the next after that? But there definitely came a point when I suddenly went, I don't care anymore. It's the polygon count's gone up to amazing now, but I really am not enjoying half of this stuff. I know, Chris, you still play modern games.
So you'll see
both sides of this. But I definitely got to a certain point and started going, actually, I like the old stuff better. And started looking back in the rear direction.
Yeah.
To the past, and that was where there was suddenly a point. Oh God, I must have been just out of uni a bit later into my 20s when I found an emulator on a PC that played Amiga badly, but it played it, and that for me was a turning point of like, oh my God, I can play this stuff again. I haven't played this for 5 years or 10 years or whatever it was, and I can play it again. And that was the suddenly I did a 360. Or no, that'd have been facing back to the same way again. A 180.
I did a 180.
And that was it. And I was like, how much more? What else can I play then? Yeah. That I didn't get round to playing when I was a kid. That I missed out on. That I didn't finish. And then I was in. And I think at that point, the future started carried on by itself. And I stopped really caring too much. And I've always bought the next console along. I keep doing it.
And selling it.
You know what I mean? It's like, I had four PS4s. I had three Switches. And within months, it's just been sat there because I've been playing retro stuff and it's just not been turned on. It's like, it's a waste of money. There's 200 quid sitting next to the telly. Just get rid of it. So that was for me, that was that turning point. There was a point at that when I stopped caring what the next generation was and was far more interested in going back to relive those experiences.
I think going back to the core question about the biggest change within the last 10 years, I think what shocked me is that the arrival of devices like the Raspberry Pi and what they've done to the retro video game and computer game community, they've actually, in many cases, brought back to life these older machines that had no right to continue to exist because they weren't designed to.
Yeah.
And I think the ability to put Raspberry Pis into Amigas and Vectrexes and all other sorts of machines makes them into something they weren't originally designed to do, and it's quite liberating to do that. And, you know, I've done it to an Amiga. It's quite extraordinary when you do it, because you think, oh, hang on, is it an Amiga anymore? Probably not. Mm. But it's still longer, you know, give it a greater longevity. You know, longevity. It keeps going, and same with CD32. There's add-on cards there that, you know, triple or quadruple its power and its speed. And it shoves a bunch of games on a card, and you don't even need the CD-ROM anymore. It's just all on this bloody SD card. It's quite extraordinary. That's the biggest change for me, is the cottage industry, even more than that, that's grown around the hobby, and all these people making these expansion boards and enhancements, and everything from putting like mounts for your motherboard in your Breadbin C64s, and yes, that does exist, through to, yes, accelerator boards that put, you know, 060s into A1200s, if you know what that means. It's just incredible.
How do you feel about these, like, vampire boards and stuff for the Amiga?
Yeah,
where exactly. It becomes...
Not an Amiga anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are we pushing these machines too far, do you think?
I mean,
how far is it no longer what it was?
Yeah.
You're going into the danger area of you're doing stuff because you can, not because it's right for the platform.
Yeah, for me, if it's faster than a 4000, because that was the top of the range, then what is it now? Is it like a next generation Amiga? I don't know what it is. I mean, there's a new version of Workbench now.
Yeah. This is the thing, though, because, like, that means nothing to me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care. Yeah. Because that's not nostalgia to me. That's not taking me back to anything.
No,
that's
something that's
repurposed into something else now and new, and not doesn't hold any nostalgia for me. There's no memories in there. Okay, now there's a new operating system of Workbench, and it's very nice now, and you can play music and stuff and connect to the internet, even though you could with the other one. But there's nothing in there for me.
Yeah.
Nothing. The only time I've ever tried to speed stuff up is to try and make Stunt Car Racer go faster.
You know,
I really want that to happen.
Yeah, you know, you're reminding me, you know, when I had my Amiga, every time I've got some more memory or I've got an accelerator, first thing you do is Stunt Car Racer, does it run any faster?
That's all
right. That was the measure.
But the nostalgia, though, was setting up those OSs and how it worked, and it built, you know, build your knowledge up, and I guess it's still, you know, great today seeing people work on it and expand it even further than it was, but I guess how far is it going to go is another question.
It's so far away from what it was that it's unrecognisable.
Yeah.
That's the problem, do you know what I mean? It's like loading up. It's like having pure nostalgia for, say, Mac OS back in the day when it was black and white, it was all like Windows and that, and then seeing Mac OS now and going, oh, I'm still getting the nostalgia. It's like, no, you're not. It's not even close. It's not in the same ballpark. It's not the same thing. It's something new. So, yeah, it runs on the hardware, great, but it's not for me. I don't get anything out of it.
No, I gotta admit, with all this new Amiga stuff, I'm not really interested. Whereas people probably say, well, Dean, you love the Spectrum Next.
Mm.
It's similar.
But then that's
it is and
else.
It isn't. You know,
it's a new machine, though, in a way, which is a good thing. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's like,
it's doing what it was designed to do, whereas you're changing something to something that it never was.
Yes, it was. Yeah. The Next is built from the outset to be a new computer, still to be based on an 8-bit processor. That's key. Mm. Running much faster, of course, but it's a different thing. I mean, there's also other devices that also emulate the things that the computers did in a way while not wearing out the equipment. For example, GoTek drives.
Yeah.
There's many that they still load at the same speed.
Yeah.
They can go faster, but they just go regular speed. And some of them actually do have sound.
I got my one. I've got a little speaker.
Little
tiny £2 of it costs me. Why is it in? It does the clicking.
It does
the
click
of the drive.
So really cool. And also, Arduino, or those tape emulators where you put tape files and it loads the tape digitally from a file rather than a tape, an audio tape.
This kind of stuff's awesome.
Yeah,
this
that, thing. I can see, you're right, I'm for. It's just, when you start to go in the other place and turn it into something else,
as an example, like the new Workbench, for example, that does nothing for me. It's all Amiga, and it's all developed on Amiga and blah, 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 but it doesn't do anything for me. But the Amiga Mini, I'm interested. I don't need one. Got a Mr. MrFPGA.co.uk. check it out. Go through it now. But the new, so the Amiga Mini, just for the pure sake, is that still repackaging those memories for me?
Yeah.
In a different way. Yep. And it's bringing a new little thing to the thing. It's bringing save states, which I didn't have.
No.
You know what I mean? That's nice. Yeah, that's cool. Brilliant. Because I'd love to go back and play some of those games that I couldn't complete.
You can finally play a PDA.
Probably. Yeah, and I can practice and carry on. Do you know what I mean? And I think that's nice, and that is bringing stuff back to the general public as well. There'll be people who like would love to play Amiga games again, but don't want to go and buy an Amiga. Don't know how to set up Win UAE because that is not easy unless you know what you're doing. Could just buy this in the shop and plug it in straight into the HDMI telly,
and off you go.
And off they go.
You can see
the
feel
that.
For that.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, it worked for the mini consoles. I still have mine hooked up to one screen. But yeah, it's really they're wonderful devices. My favourite is the PC Engine Mini, fantastic machine.
Yeah, I'd get one.
Yeah,
super cute.
Yeah, good. But although the USB's died on, apparently, if you're not careful, somewhat worrying. But I think that's the other thing that's happened in the last 10 years is the minis. You know, I do remind people that the NES Mini, I think, is 5 years ago now. Amazingly.
Was it really?
2016.
Wow. That is incredible.
5 years.
2016. That's when it came out.
I'm starting to feel old again.
That was the first one.
It's retro.
Retro now.
Well, there's something else to change in 10 years. And it's the evolution of what retro is. And for me, it's not green. But, and I don't think for Dean either. It's now moved to a point where you're like looking at PS2 into even PS3.
Yeah.
Being retro. And that for me doesn't take any boxes.
It depends on your age.
Of course it does. Yeah.
You know, it's going to be.
There's all sorts of rules.
Guys younger than us.
Yeah.
That was their first system.
Yes.
So now they're going to be looking back at that and thinking, oh, wow, yeah, that takes me right back.
Yeah.
Well, there's
the PS3 was probably where I thought, I think I've had enough of this.
Yeah.
Unfortunately. Life. I think it depends on your circumstances in life. You know, for me, I'd had kids by that point. I found it very hard to find the time to play those sort of games. Whereas the PS2, I've got some great memories. The Dreamcast, great memories. You know, obviously the PlayStation 1 and stuff before that. So, I think just for me, it was just a point of those games, from that point on, were taking too much time to play. I know I'm always banging on about not having enough time to play these games, but that's what stopped me.
Hundreds of hours. What did you say you played?
So I played Assassin's Creed Valhalla, which came out last a year ago to almost to the day, and that took 142 hours to finish.
I don't think I played 142 seconds of it.
Yeah,
as far as I got.
That's a good point though, because you know years ago you had 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you'd go and play a game. Now you go, oh, there's no point playing a game. I've only got an hour and a half.
It depends on the game.
That's the time it takes to install it there.
It does.
The amount of times
that people go, I used to log games off tapes, they used to take 10 minutes to load. I'm like, your update takes 4 hours.
And then the server goes down, you can't play anyway.
Yeah, so don't be giving me that.
I mean, smaller indie games, you can do what you just described.
Yeah. And there's been that to come back. Which is
there's lots and lots of titles out there you can just jump into. Although I do joke that the first game I played on my Xbox Series X was Jetpack.
Good. And the only one, and then sell it.
I
do remember leaving the Spectrum for days because we were playing a game that I just didn't know how to save. So I just left it on.
And it was right, Nelson when you came back to it.
Leave it on.
Yeah.
Your mum didn't find out.
That does worry me because now opening a lot of those up over the years, they have these dirty great metal heat sinks over the power regulator. And like, oh my goodness.
For me, though, it's about patience or lack of. Because like the amount of times now, because I test games and work with my team and stuff, and the amount of times I'll take a look at this, it's meant to be great. And I'll go into the tutorial and it'll show me a map of like 25 buttons that I need to remember. Left trigger does this, right trigger does this.
Mm-hmm.
L1 does this, L stick does this. Press this up to bring this guide up, bring this up. And I just go, I just can't be arsed. It's too much, I just don't care. And I don't like games with, and you'll hate me for this, itineraries where you have to carry loads of crap around with you. Open your itinerary, put all this crap, what do I want to do that for? I wander around aimlessly in life. Don't need to do it on my computer as well.
And what's even worse, though, is when you fill your inventory, it's like, well, what do I drop?
Yeah.
To
Yeah. We're doing all this crap.
It's dizzy all over
crafting.
Again.
Yeah, that's been around since Ultima days, so let's not lay that at the feet of modern games. But I do take your point.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, modern games aside and that kind of thing, it's for me, just going back to that point, is the original core question was the major change, was the reawakening, or the people recognising that video games do have a lineage and a heritage, just like the other regular media does, like music and film and literature, and people are really starting to recognise that now. The fact that Radio 3 has a video game music section on Saturday afternoon says a lot.
Does it?
It does. Sound of Gaming. They can't call it Sound of Play because, that's what Kane and Rince has. They wanted to call it that, but we said, no, that's fine, we'll call it Sound of Gaming. So they do. And yeah, Saturday afternoon, Radio 3 of all things. For an afternoon, they just put on music. And they actually do talk about...
Here I am, starting the first UK's retro gaming podcast, and now I've got Radio 3.
You didn't think of that 10 years ago.
Yes.
Older games, though, they were tough. They were hard. Mm. You know, you had to learn to be good, and you achieved something. I think a lot of newer games now, they've become more an experience.
You just
progress through it, you know?
And I thought I was good back then. Well, I'm certainly not.
Oh, no.
You go back to those games now and just demolish me.
I think they're a lot more story-driven these days than they were.
There's no Jeopardy. Jeopardy
isn't a bad thing.
There's no Jeopardy anymore. Name me a game that you can lose.
Dark Souls.
Apart from Dark Souls, which is pretty much based upon Ghosts and Goblins.
But I think your mind changed a little bit as well. I mean, I loved the original Tomb Raider. Blew my mind when I had it.
Yeah.
And I wanted to play it again.
Respect the grid.
Yeah, but now it drives me insane. Because to save game points, you know, and you'll spend 10 minutes. I can't quite work out where to jump to, so I'll just try that. Obviously wrong. I'm dead.
Back
15 minutes back to go all the way back to try another one. Wrong again. I'm done with this now.
Right.
You know?
Whereas I personally played it on the PC, so I was just hitting F5. Okay. Here's a bit on fine. Because PC Master Race, because that's what we did.
Master Disgrace.
Yeah. I hate that phrase, so sorry. Thanks, PC Gamer. People are terrible.
Anyway, should we start wrapping this up? Because we've gone completely off topic about our 10-year anniversary and visit to arcade. But it's been like a normal episode, in fact.
Yeah.
Just chewing the fat.
Yeah. So, overall, it was a shame that Mads and Chris couldn't make it, but we've still managed to have a good day, I think.
Yeah, absolutely, without a doubt. Yeah. You know, and I think we should say thanks to you guys as well. I mean, over the 10 years, you brought us a lot of enjoyment. You know, you've passed away many, many hours while we've been doing the boring stuff and walking around listening to you guys. So thanks for the last 10 years.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for tuning in and putting up with us.
It's all worth it. Well, this is the thing, isn't it? You never know who's listening when you put this stuff out, or if anyone's listening, especially at first.
Yeah. I mean, I've listened to you guys more than my wife, so...
I don't know if that's a good thing.
Should we keep that in?
I'm going to tell her.
Okay.
Just get us to talk about the 80s.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Cool.
Right, okay. Well, thank you guys for joining us for this episode. We much appreciate it. And thank you for coming to our 10-year anniversary. And thank you, Chris, for joining us again.
Good to
see you.
You're
welcome. Nothing about Greenby Islands this time. Oh, damn, there it is. We will be a part 3 and 8-bit wars.
At some point.
Yeah, we'll do another one. Yeah. I might even take part again.
Yeah.
So, I'll do a quick shout out to the boys who we'll hopefully have on the second part of this episode.
Yep. And sorry, you couldn't join us.
Yeah.
You missed a blast.
Yeah, it was good.
Very good. Missed out.
Right. Speak to you soon, guys. Thanks for listening.
Bye bye.
Bye.
Hi, I'm Dean Swain, spokesperson for Retro Asylum. This letter is from Sebastian Loyes, a French exchange student. Sebastian says, I tried Retro Asylum and I didn't enjoy it as much as other podcasts. Well, Sebastian, all I can say is, sorry. We've done all we can. We try to provide satisfaction for all Retro Asylum listeners, even if you are only visiting our great nation. It's not easy. My friend Andy here has been working on RAP for 3 years.
You're an exchange student, aren't you, Sebastian? All here, Joe, on fancy loafers. What are your credentials, Sebastian? What drives you? When did you last get up at 4 a.m. for something that you believed in passionately? We don't need you, you hear? You're one dissenting voice in a binium, Johnny French. Yeah, that's... Yes, Retro Asylum is a charge to the earbuds. Yes, it's feisty. Yes, it's got guts. But so have we, Sebastian. Look at us. Come on in, Sebastian. Come on. Right here. Right now. You and me. Come on, France. Europe. The world. I take you all on. I'm Dean Swain. I listen to Retro Asylum. Come and get me.
I've got an idea, boys, for next year. Now, knock me back, but why don't we go and visit Retro Man Cave's cave?
Absolutely.
Good idea, yeah.
Cool. Yeah, I'd love to do that.
Not for that. Do an RA event from there. Yeah. Do an RA event
from
there.
We'll do an RA thing. We'll have a word with him and see if we can go down and we'll do a recording in there and stuff.
Yeah.
But it looks absolutely fantastic. I've shown some new videos as he's finished it. It looks amazing. He's got all consoles and he's got a few little arcade machines, but he's got all the game stuff. He's made a shop that looks like W.H. Smith's.
It is mega. Utterly
it
mega.
Looks phenomenal. But it also looks like a nice place, like where it is, where it's located in the country.
Yeah. It's a beautiful building. It's Gloucestershire way. So.
Okay.
It's Gloucestershire way. So I looked it up on the map. It's about 3 hours for me. And I think it's probably about the same for you
it's
guys.
It's about 3 hours from everywhere, I think, yeah. Gloucester. Yeah.
For all of us.
Five
so it's the
for
same.
Dean and Chris.
No, it's not too bad for me.
It's about three. I checked from Essex and it's about 3 hours.
It's about 12 hours for Mads, but that's all right.
Yeah, yeah.
That's fine.
No worries.
He can kip in your study, Chris. It's fine.
He can.
Yeah.
He can kip amongst all the computers and everything. He'd love it.
He would love
there
it.
There you go.
He would love it.
But I'm thinking next year when the weather turns a bit nicer again, we'll book a hotel or whatever and we'll stay the night. And
sounds
we'll
like
go down, we'll do it for the day and we'll go for a meal.
Yeah. So Neil... we're booking your man cave next year for the Retro Southern get-together. We've done that live on the show tonight.
Yeah, whether you like it or not.
We've immortalised it on the 10th anniversary episode.
That's a great idea, Steve.
Love it.
Neil can come for a curry with us. We'll take him for a curry.
Yeah.
If he
nice
gives
part
us free
of the
tickets.
World as well.
I'm just kidding. But yeah, that's an idea for next year, and I think it'll be a little bit more chilled. It won't be chocker like that's... Arcade Club was, because I know people can be a bit nervous with the COVID stuff. So
I think it's more the sociability as well. You know, something like the man cave is going to be more intimate, less
yeah,
noisy,
not got to shout so much,
less noisy, less aircon blowing in your face, all that kind of stuff, which just makes it more intimate, like we say. And you know, you
but
actually
he,
get
he
to
said
talk
on his
to people.
Yeah, and he said on his channel as well, he's only taking small bookings for it each time.
Yeah,
he's not having the place filled out with loads of people
and
it being chocker.
Yeah.
So it'll just be like, you know, 10 of us or something if we get a few, anyone on Discord wants to come along or whatever. But
that's a raffle some
we'll work it out.
Raffle some tickets.
Yeah, we'll work out something for next year. But I think that could be a nice little weekend for us. Go there. Nice place in the part of the country. Stay the night. Go for a meal.
Yeah, lovely, lovely.
That's my idea.
And talking about something like the Man Cave, I think if we go back 10 years, you know, we've spoken about the fact that we were the first UK podcast, proper UK podcast, I guess. Not disrespecting 1H, whatever it's called, 1HMPS. Yeah. But first...
100 mile per hour. Service.
That's the one. But not disrespecting that. What has happened in that last 10 years? Industry, YouTubers, influencers, people tagging onto the, you know, shirt tails of retro because they want to become an influencer. And I say that sort of slightly sort of tongue-in-cheek, but it's true, isn't it? You know, there's where there's an industry and where there's money to be made, you're going to get people coming into it, regardless of what their background is. So... we've seen it change from being a very hobbyist thing, and actually the price is not too bad in 2010, 2011, second-hand prices, to what we see now. Is that change is phenomenal, because I think from 2001 to 2010, it wasn't anything like that. But the last 10 years has just been phenomenal growth, good and bad. But it's now an industry that earns money, I'd say. You know, people have jobs in this industry. You know, you've interviewed Evercade recently. You got the Caulfields on last week as well.
Yeah.
You know, there is a genuine money-making industry behind it. And I don't begrudge anyone wanting to make money out of it who's a retailer or who's making a console or making a documentary or anything like that. But what a difference.
Yeah.
Yeah, the likes of Antstream as well. And
exactly. You know, Antstream's a huge company. And
bringing these old games out again.
And do you think that the podcasting world has driven that in some way?
I think to a certain extent, yeah. Yeah, I mean, there was Retro Asylum, and now there's a lot of other UK retro gaming podcasts, isn't there? You know, so I think we've probably inspired a few people in that regard. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying that if it wasn't for RA, there wouldn't be Evercade or Antstream or you know, anything like that. But I think it's certainly inspired people to do the same, you know, and that's not saying that copying or anything like that, but it's opened up avenues, hasn't it? It's opened up avenues for us as individuals and contacts and whatever else, and avenues for everyone else to do the same kind of thing. Obviously, there's been a natural progression anyway, I think, or whatever, but why not be the first doing it, and why not be the ones that sort of trail that blaze forward for other people?
There's a viability to it, Matt. I think that's what's really, for me, that's changed. Retro is now not just a hobby, obvious scene. It's a viable commercial thing. Mm. You know, companies like Bitmapsoft can run a business solely based on publishing games for systems that released 40 years ago. Mm. And that, I don't think that would have flown 10 years ago in the way it has. And I think now there is enough of a scene, if you like, there's enough of a market there to make businesses like that viable. I also think in some respects, we have come full circle as well. I mean, rewind 10 years. Who would have thought that a company could have released not one, but two systems based on new physical media that primarily runs old games?
It's great. It's fantastic. Yeah. You know, you look at the Next and the Minis. You know, the Minis.
They're making money.
Minis, Nintendo, Sega, you know, big, dominant companies releasing retro stuff is just fantastic. Coming back, you said Bitmapsoft as well. Bitmap Books, Sam, ex-host of the podcast. I have no doubt that if it wasn't for the podcast, he wouldn't have had that sort of kernel of an idea to go, hold on a minute, there's interest in this stuff. I could do something here with the skills I have. And, you know, all due respect to Sam, he's gone on to do great things on that. And,
all this stuff is reaching the mainstream market now as well. I was in an electronics job here recently, just a few days ago, buying an Evercade, which I found in a normal electronics shop here in Denmark. Nothing that would normally be having a lot of gaming stuff, but they had Ad Games consoles, they had D64, they had the Evercade, they had some of the other minis, the Mega Drive Mini, for example. All of that was there in their little gaming corner. So that was, I mean, retro was maybe a tenth of their gaming display right now.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Argos, you've got to look at Argos, right? Last year, I remember seeing the C64 in Argos, all the minis in Argos. And I'm just thinking, you know, 30 years ago, we saw those systems in there before and we're seeing them again. Yeah. And that is cool. That is cool.
Look at the clip that I'd done ages ago. We'd done a wind-up on game.
Oh, that we rung was them so up good.
And we asked them if they had any ZX Spectrum games or Mega Drive games, stuff like that. And it was all tongue-in-cheek. A few people got the ump with us doing it because, you're upsetting their staff. But back then, they didn't sell any of this stuff. Most of their staff wouldn't have known what a Mega Drive was, and, you know, especially a Spectrum. But now, they sell gadgets that will run Spectrum games and NES games and Atari games and Mega Drive games. You know, you didn't have that back then when we started.
Well, you directly influenced them, Dean.
No, I'm not saying that at all. What I'm saying is,
take a cut of their profits, mate.
You know, we could do a joke. We run game up and ask them if they've got Manic Miner on the ZX Spectrum. And the guy didn't have it's WH Smith. But we did ring game up and ask them if they had Mega Drive games.
I tell you, they wouldn't laugh at you now.
No, exactly. They didn't have a clue what we was on about. Mm. But now they would have an idea. That's what I'm saying. I'm not saying we were responsible for that, not at all.
It would be outlandish now for them to stock Mega Drive games.
Yeah.
Because one was released a couple of years ago.
Mm. Mm. Yeah, and it also means that we even now see an influx to our Discord server of younger people.
Yes.
We see a few young people there, just in their 20s, and they're probably just getting into this through, for example, the mini consoles, because they wouldn't have grown up with this at all.
Yeah.
Well, I was on Spectrum forum earlier today, and there was a guy asking, I think he had a ZX81, and he was saying he wasn't getting a picture from it. And someone said, have you tried plugging it into a CRT TV? And he said, what is a CRT TV? He didn't have a clue what it was. You know, he's used to LCD screens, like a lot of most people. So, yeah, there is. There's young people come into it now. And, yeah, it has changed.
Here's so a follow-up. Here's a follow-up question then. Do we think that there is a saturation point coming down the line? We've got, you know, we're just at the Caulfields have got their film coming out about the Spectrum. There's been many films about the Spectrum. We've had a lot of books, Amiga and Pixels. We've got Sam's books. Fast forward 10 years, is there a point of diminishing returns,
I think if you look at eBay prices first, let's just tackle that for a moment, right? So it's astronomical on anything that's slightly collectible, because all the collectors are buying them now. It's not people like us that want to play them. It's people that want to collect them and put them on a shelf and, you know, that's it. And they're done with that. And I know I heard something recently about something for sale on eBay that another collector contacts that person and said, that's too low a price. You're ruining the prices for us collectors.
Yeah, I've heard that similar.
Yeah, and I think so you're going to run out of these big games and the games that or systems as well. You're going to run out of that at some point. Not completely, but it's going to get to a point where they're just, there isn't a market for it. So it's going to push up things like that. But I think there's going to be a point where I don't think the likes of us are just going to pay that kind of price. So the more casual retro game, and I find it hard to call us casual retro gamers because we're not, but we're not collectors that want to shove stuff on a shelf and, you know, polish it and, you know, have a full collection. That's their prerogative. Yeah. And whether that's an investment or because they genuinely have a passion, again, their prerogative. I think from that point of view, we may see eBay prices for the more general stuff lowering a little bit. In terms of what you said, though, Chris, I don't know. I think I said it earlier, it's an industry now, isn't it? So I don't think there is saturation. You can, I guess you can only say so much about a system. Like, you know, Sam's done books on Amigas. Chris Wilkins done books on Amigas. Other people have done books on Amigas. What more can you write about an Amiga? Yeah. I mean, you know, there's Zap 64s just coming out and it's going to cover the Amiga and there's Crash as well. And I just think at some point they're going to run out of stuff to talk about because there's not going to be all the new homebrew games.
Yeah.
You know, at the moment he's sort of working backwards on homebrew games, but at some point you're going to run out of those games and there's only going to be like one a month. And how are you going to do a whole magazine on that? Which would be a shame because I think those magazines are good.
There's been a massive explosion of magazines, hasn't there, in the past, 3-4 years?
Yeah, but surely...
So many now.
You can't go for all of them, can you? Sure. You can't afford to do that.
You can't, and you're going to run. You are genuinely going to run out of stuff to talk about at some point, unless you just keep on retrospectively looking at things, of course. There's always stuff to talk about there.
There's only so long that remains interesting, though, isn't it?
That's the point, isn't it? That's the point. But there is some good stuff like that now. What do you think, Chris? You mentioned it. Do you think there is a saturation point?
I think there's definitely a saturation point with this stuff, definitely. Because I think, as you've said, Matt, there's only so much you can say about the Amiga. There's only so much you can say about the Spectrum. But I think there's a lot of things that are unsaid about other systems. I mean, Mads has mentioned recently in our chat about, you know, when is someone going to do a film on the Amstrad?
Yeah,
I mean that might exist, but if it does, I don't know of it.
Yeah, I think there's definitely a very interesting story there to be told. Definitely. I think the trouble is, like, in regards to the Caulfields, it'd have to be a Kickstarter campaign.
Yeah,
and I think they worry if there's going to be. They haven't said this to me. I'm guessing that they're worried that there isn't a big enough Amstrad market.
Yeah, they're right to worry.
It's the problem, isn't it? When you get to a niche platform, you run out, and you don't run out of people, but there are less and less people that are interested.
I should imagine a lot of people are interested in 8-bit systems who maybe don't own an Amstrad might back a project like that.
There's less because it'd be interesting. It,
there is, but Yeah, and there's going to be a thousand Amstrad owners, if there is a thousand, moaning
at me right now.
I had to get that in
there.
I had to get that
in. But you're spot on, though, Dean. And they're right to worry about it, because you mentioned Spectrum and you mentioned C64 and you mentioned Amiga and people's
nostalgia.
Well,
I mentioned Amstrad as well.
Yeah, but people's...
You notice I didn't answer that question. So.
But people's nostalgia neurons, the every man down the street, you mention Amiga. Oh, I used to have an Amiga. There's not that same kind of feeling for the Amstrad. Although, you know, the five of us would be really interested in it, as would most of our listeners. It's just whether you've got that wider appeal.
Yeah, can you imagine as well, though? Because David Pleasant's very much come into the Amiga scene, hasn't he, these days? You know, he's written a book, another one's on the cards. But... He's at the shows. He talks, you know, he's very much integral in the scene. Can you imagine Alan Sugar suddenly turning up at retro events?
Must be hard up.
I'd like to see that.
Yeah, it'd be great. So we've got an industry, which is all good. What about your personal journeys through the last 10 years? Like, quite briefly. So mine has been, obviously, emulation, Mister now. I think I'm still playing the same old games I always played 10 years ago as well. You know, whenever I set up a new emulation, I know Steve loves setting up, used to love setting up emulation stuff. You end up on the same 20 games always, just to see, it works just as well here. I think with the Mister, I think we need to touch on FPGA in a bit. But I was going to say, with Mister, it just feels a little bit different this time around. But for me, I've been through the whole lot. Emulation, the mini consoles, which I've sold most of them now. In fact, I've still got the SNES one, which probably needs to be sold now. I've got a Mister. But I'm very much the same. I do play the same old games, but then I am veering off now. And you mentioned it earlier, Chris, about, what did you say, analysis paralysis or something like that? Where
choice paralysis,
same kind of thing. You know what I mean. And I'm trying not to do that. I'm trying not to put whole ROM sets on and actually playing the games that I've got more. So that's been my journey over the last 10 years. Of course, this show, absolutely. And I think actually, more than anything, I've actually done more and more retro over the last 10 years. That's why I got into it in the first place. Why I got into the podcast in the first place. I wanted to do more of it.
Yeah.
And we get to the time of year where I love playing games as well. Well, we're in that time of year, I love playing games. So that's all good. Dean, you've gone from saying on the first show, you are Mr. Emulation, to we're looking at his shed behind him, listeners, and it is just chock full of stuff.
Lots of emulators.
It's just a virtual background on Zoom, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. This ain't really mine. Never has been. I just felt, you know, the more, like you said earlier, the early episodes, it was a lot of Spectrum talk and a bit of Atari from myself. And Andy would talk about Commodore 64 and Amstrad because he had owned those machines. And I just felt, if I'm going to carry on talking about this, if I'm going to carry on with the show, I need to have these machines because I'd played on them when I was younger. But, you know, I was a bit of a fanboy for the Spectrum and for the Atari. I wanted to give those machines a fighting chance and be able to generally talk about them and know what I was on about. So, yeah, I started picking up systems. In fact, the first one I did was the Vectrex, because I've been eager to own one of those for years. When they first come out, I wanted one, couldn't afford one. And then Woolworths were selling them off cheap, and my mum wouldn't buy me one at the time. And then the prices just went up and up and up. And... I bought one of those. But yeah, I bought a Commodore 64, bought an Amstrad, and it just snowballed, you know. You ended up getting a Mega Drive, then a SNES. Then I thought, I want an NES because my mate used to have one of those. I want a Sega Master System because another pal of mine had one of those. And it becomes like an addiction.
Yeah, but it's your hobby though, Dean. You know, we all need something to... escape to of an evening or of a weekend, and you know it's all our hobbies, isn't it? Just so your journey is collecting hardware. We could be flippant and say Steve buys and sells stuff, but actually that's what you enjoy doing. You like playing on something for a bit and then getting rid of it and getting something else. But I think you've settled on a few systems now. And what
for now.
But what else has been that journey for you, Steve? From the last 10 years?
So I think similar to Dean, sort of. I started off in the emulation zone. That was where I first discovered all the retro gaming stuff, like playing stuff on a PC.
Oh, dear.
I know. That's where it started. You know, I mean, obviously didn't have a Mac back then anyway. But that's really where it started, where it could emulate something and it be half decent and representative of the original thing. And I, for a long time, was just emulation. This is it for me. It's brilliant. But then slowly, having got the nostalgia, that kick out of those games that I wanted to, started to think, well, what would it be like on actual hardware? Because I bet you there was more to it than just what I'm seeing on my PC. And, you know, the tangible feel of the tape deck and the joystick and using the keyboard and typing load and all that kind of stuff. So eventually moved from just emulating stuff to starting to buy a bit of hardware, got a Commodore 64, ended up building an arcade machine myself because I really wanted one. I think every kid's dream from our era was to one day own an arcade machine.
Still want one.
So I ended up building one with my brother, a full-size one, which was cool. And then eventually sort of got more hardware. And I think I've come I've sort of gone around in circles a little bit because like you said before, Matt, I do sort of buy and sell a lot. And what tends to happen with me is I buy something, I'm really excited about it, and I'm that way for about a month. I love it. It's the best thing I've ever owned. I'm going to play it all the time. And then suddenly, I don't know what happens, I move, my brain moves onto something else and that thing gets left
How
there.
Much did the Mr. Go for, Steve?
That's still there, mate. Don't you worry. The thing that's not going anywhere, and there's a reason that's not going anywhere, is that there's nothing that could replace that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There's nothing else that can do what that does. Now, I've had Commodore 64s, I've had a couple of them, I've had Amigas. I've still got the Amiga Chris gave me. Very grateful. I love it. And I assume some of these things are like, you know, when you say you get your forever home, it's like some of these things, it's like you get your forever computer and it's like, that's not going anywhere now. That's my Amiga. That's it. It's staying. I'm done.
It's true. I'm just going to jump in and like you, Steve, I sell things all the time. And I was just going the other day, I've not turned it on for about 3 weeks. What's the point in having it? And then I pulled myself back in line. I went, hold on a minute. It does everything I want it to do properly, pretty much.
Yeah.
And it's just got this timeline. You know, PlayStation 1's coming, Saturn's coming, whatever else is going to come in the future. You may need to buy a new board at some point. But it just feels like it's a platform now in its own right. You know, Neil Retro Man Cave's done his own console version of it. And I think this is the future platform of retro, you know, without real hardware and real cartridges and media and that sort of stuff.
Yeah. Well, I mean, so that's kind of where I've ended up with the Mister. I've sold more hardware again in the end, and I've tried emulating again and with bits and bobs, handhelds, went through a load of them for a bit, had a bit of fun with them, ended up with this Mister. And it's kind of like you've hit the pinnacle of what, not emulating, but simulating your hardware could possibly be, at least at this level. I think they could go a new Mister later on down the track that could do Dreamcast and PlayStation 3 and all that kind of stuff. But to be fair, stuff that I'm not very interested in. So, like I said, this is pinnacle for me. But it feels like there isn't anywhere else I could go from the Mister that's going to improve on the Mister, that's going to be a better experience. It feels like hardware because everything runs like the real hardware. I've got the Commodore 64 next to it, and I can run them side by side. And there is no difference, nothing.
Yeah,
it's absolutely. I can do it with an emulator, and you can tell the difference. They're not quite in time with each other. The music's going a bit faster on that one. This one's like frames drop there. The control doesn't feel right there. When you're doing it with the Mister, it's become the hardware, and suddenly you are just play. It just has that feel like the real hardware. It has that feel of when you really play the Amiga or you really play the actual hardware. That's the feeling you get from it, is that this is real.
You could debate all day, couldn't you, that there's that this minutia between emulation and FPGA, but there is a definite difference between the two.
Your animal brain knows the difference.
And I think from pressing that fire button to the sound coming on, to the movement on the screen happening, to the response back to your eyes, there is just something. There is something different about it. And, you know, I noticed it most, and I think I've said this before, was actually on the Spectrum 128 start screen where you go up and down and you could select 128K basic and that. It was that, and I was on my keyboard going, Jesus, that's quick. That doesn't feel like an emulator. Yeah, and there's no screen tear like on an emulator. Very slight screen tear. I mean, Spectrum is emulated really, really bloody well, but there was still something. Anyway, we're going off on a tangent. Sorry, Steve.
Yeah.
Short time.
So, yeah. Cheers. So that's where my journey's gone. Certainly with retro, it's gone from the emulation through into the hardware kind of thing, gone sort of around in a couple of circles. I've ended up with the Mister. And on a sort of side note, as you guys all know, the music situation I'm in now as well with my band and stuff, that's and I've got to say this, has been heavily influenced by the podcast and retro and gaming. And all that side of it has all come to play in where my music is going and my band and stuff. That's all come from this.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I should point that out, you know what I mean? So I've always been doing music projects on the side. You've always known that I've been doing music stuff in the background, going to studio once a week or twice a week and working on stuff. But it's only when me and the guys have decided to like make a project that we were like, what do we want this to be? And my first thought was like 80s music. Let's make 80s music or modern 80s music. And then as we sort of developed that, it was like, well, what do you guys want to do? They like 80s music, so that was not an issue. But for me, and I'm probably the main lyricist for the band, it's telling these stories. And I was like, I want to talk about these memories. I want to talk about being a kid, playing games, going to the arcade, hanging out with your mates, going out on your bike, staying out all day and not coming back until it's tea time. All these things were baked into what the band has become. And it's come from this, if that makes sense.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the next single is called Loads. Damn it, you bugger.
Yeah. Screen of death.
I'll take Load Error. On a similar level. So I've done some sound packs for synthesizers. And I name a lot of the patches after games and after Amiga stuff. My label, the last set of releases, all the EPs have been named after something on the Amiga. And previous to that, it was named after something retro-y. Like one was called the Raster EP, one was called the Scanline EP. And, you know, I'm similarly influenced by that. And that's come from this as well. And it fascinates me. There's people out there who are looking at this stuff, just seeing a name like Iridium or Epidia. And they don't know what that
means. Relating to it.
They might not relate to it.
Oh, yeah.
They might just look at it and go, that's a strange name. But for us, there might just be one person who goes, he's a fan.
I wonder if anybody's got kids called Angus and Paul.
Maybe so.
That'd be the extreme.
You need
it?
To change yours. Change yours by default, mate. So, Matt. Go on, Troy.
Sorry, so yeah, you're right. You know what I mean? And that's even where the band name came from. It's the same thing that you've just mentioned. Do you know what I mean? It's like we sat there and we were coming up with all stupid names. And in the end, we got this, like, I want to mention the arcade because that is something that relates directly to the 80s in reality. Because that's when it existed in its element and then disappeared over time into nothing anymore. Yeah. You know, apart from like arcade club and stuff. But for us, our generation, the arcade, is that represents our generation. And then the last, it was initially the Lost Arcade. Yeah. And then we went the Lost or the Last. And I was like, the Last, because the Last Starfighter.
Yeah.
The Raiders of the Lost Ark. Or there was a few, but there was the Last This, the Last That. And I was like, 80s films as well.
Yeah.
It ties in the Last Arcade. You know what I mean? So anyway, I've gone on a slight tangent, but that's been my journey through retro. And that has, where I am now, has been propelled by retro and by this podcast and the 10 years I've spent on it.
Just before I come to Mads as well, I just want to say that ain't it effing amazing that we have such a passion, that us five people and everyone else in the retro community, right, that we can name, you're naming a band that, you know, is doing great stuff at the moment after something retro. And there's, you know, some people are out there going, well, what does that mean? But you know what it means. You've had the passion to relate it to something in your past. And I think that's stunning that we've got something. Because there's a lot of people who drift through life, go into a local pub and that's it. They might have a wife as well. You know, they might go home to that wife occasionally. But they have no passion other than just going to the pub having a pint. And I think it's wonderful that we have this thing.
Well, that thing that you just said about people recognising those names or not, the amount of people I've had come up to me since we put a couple of songs out and stuff, and going, I love the name of your band. It reminds me of being a kid. So it works.
Job done.
It does connect. Yeah. It does connect them back to that time of the 80s and all the rest of it. So
job done, mate. You know, yeah,
that's the whole point.